Anyway, welcome. I'm so glad you came. And just a couple things up front. If you need water, if you go up the road there, you'll see a black 4Runner. There's a drinking fountain right there. If you have a water bottle and somebody is willing to pump, I got a hand pump, and that's going to be the coldest, cleanest water because it's going through less plumbing, and it's really, really good. My water's really good, so you need a couple water bottle emptied out because this is you'll like this water here. And if you have to go to the bathroom, just continue on down the road past the house, go around the house. When you get around the house, you look off to the left, you'll see this little wood-fired oven with a green roof. The next building next to it, the green roof, is an outhouse, and that's available to you. Otherwise, we'll get started. Just a couple things up front. This is not about me, and this is not about some gardening technique or method. There's a lot of those out there, and from my perspective, they don't work, really. They're a lot of work, and they don't really work well. What this is all about is connecting to the Creator, the Master Gardener of the universe, who did it perfect, who needs no help, who's very available and really loves to share. And connecting with Him changed my life. And this is why you're here, because I want you to experience His goodness, because He's really good. And He made it really, really easy for it. I like to use examples and contrasts are really helpful to show you just the power of the covering, how amazing when this material lays on the ground, what it does to soil. If you look at my sequoia trees right here, you look at how dark green that foliage is. No Miracle-Gro at any level would ever do that. I'm being honest. I don't care how much you used. If you look at the ground underneath, you see what's fertilizing those? The needles from the tree is the only support they get their entire lives, and they look that good. I'm just being real. Those needles are the most potent fertilizer that exists. It's incredible. And where you're standing out here, the roots from that tree are way beyond this. I mean, they really, really spread. Really. I can show you my orchard, you know, crossing my driveway. In my orchard, roots this big, you know, in the orchard, just, you know, taken off because there's a lot of good food out there. But I want to show you something. Are there gardeners here? Okay. You know when you have a tree of this size and you want to plant something near it? It's not going to happen because you dig in the ground, it's solid roots, solid root mass. I want you to observe that rhododendron growing in the root ball of my sequoia. Come look at it. See, these are the kind of things that get my attention because I've been doing this my whole life, and when I see this, this is not what I experienced when I was in dirt. Look how full that foliage is and how healthy it is. That's growing in the root ball of that sequoia tree. Looks that good. So what I want you to get is this covering, this wood chip covering, has such incredible life force that you can grow everything in the same place and there's no lack. Just to show you a contrast, if you look across the fence at that rhododendron my neighbor has,
oh, yeah. Wow.
Look at the difference.
Yeah.
I just want you, I love contrast.
That looks like mine.
And here's the insanity of what they tell us. You see, my neighbors went to the trouble of putting down landscape cloth. You can see it exposed there, that black stuff.
Oh, yeah.
With the intent to stop weeds. You notice that weed is growing quite fine on top of the landscape cloth and the wood chips. And here's the irony. The life force from those wood chips can't get to that rhododendron because the black landscape cloth is stopping it. So even though I have the wood chips there, there's no benefit because the landscape cloth is cutting it off. And they spent money to buy this stuff and labor to install it to do this damage. I'm just being real. You got to pay attention to what you're being told, because in most cases it's not true, and it's usually connected to something you have to buy to keep you a slave. Where you're going to see everything that's going on in my place, everything was created in nature for free, and it's renewable. I love that. And that's just the nature of the Creator. He's just really good, and He made it totally free for us, unlimited, with no toxic side effects. It's just ideal. And it's so fun to get it. Like, love it because it's just, it works well, you know. Look at these little blueberries in the root ball of my sequoia. They're babies. You can see they're developing with blueberries on them. They look quite green. You know, there's definitely saying we're not having any struggle here next to this big tree. It's just, look at this barberry here. Now, for those of you starting out, if you need fences, this makes the nicest fence of anything on the planet. It's beautiful, it's living, and nothing will grow through it. Barberry. No animal will ever go through that. And if you doubt that, put your hand in it. It's called barberry for a reason. No, but it's just, again, it's just a beautiful, I love the dark, you know, foliage. And again, if you see them out in people's landscapes, they don't look like this. They're a lighter red, not near as full. And just telling you, man, this stuff is screaming at me of vitality and life. And the beauty is I do nothing. I didn't do anything. I just put wood chips down and left. Here's something that really gets my attention. I was here 37 years ago. My neighbor planted this cherry tree in front of you. This is a Royal Anne cherry. And you can tell by looking at it that it's not doing quite well. A lot of dead wood. You can see the trunk's been pretty challenged. Here's the thing that gets my attention. Turn around over here and look at that cherry tree beyond that. You see how full and green and awesome that is? You want to hear something amazing? That's a Royal Anne cherry, just like this. It's 20 years younger. It was planted 17 years ago. The same cherry. And if you look at it, it's in the same light pattern, same sun, same elevation. That has a covering on the earth. This doesn't. I'm just telling you, man, it's dramatic. It's not like slightly different. It's like screaming at you how powerful a covering is over the ground. I mean, it's dramatic. Yes?
You haven't adopted your secrets anymore.
Yeah, how have your neighbors not noticed? Yes.
Can I tell you why? Everybody listen to me. My neighbors are highly educated. They have good educations. And they sent us to school to erase our brains so we don't think. I'm being real. They sent us to school to erase our brains so we don't think, so we can be controlled. If you don't think, you can be controlled. I'm being real. And just pay attention to your education. You were given information, you gave it back on a test every week, you had no clue where it came from, no idea of its validity, and you just became a parrot. Take in, put back, take in, put back, and you never thought. How come? Why? Explain. And in life, you just believe the authorities because you were trained not to think. And whatever they tell you, you think, oh, they know, they have the degree, and you follow their lies because you were trained to. So I just want to encourage you today to start thinking outside the box. Pay attention to what you're seeing, and just don't believe what you hear unless there's evidence. So let me tell you something really cool, and I'm going to demonstrate it all day long. If you don't see the example in nature of something you're being told, if you don't see the demonstration in nature, rest assured you're being lied to, and it's not true. I'm being real. I'm being really real. And if you think in agriculture, let's just use some examples. In agriculture, in nature, the ground is never disturbed. There's no tilling, ever, anywhere. In nature, there's no crop rotations. Plants go to seed, they fall on the ground year after year, decade after, and they're just fine. In nature, there's no weeds. In nature, no one's watering. In nature, no one's adjusting pH. I'm just talking to you. And so all these things they're telling me are lies. And so basically I'm demonstrating it all. I have perfect 7.0 pH. I never water. So this orchard, look at the green foliage on those trees. Look how dark green that is. And that nasturtium. Now the nasturtium, everybody come up here, because I want you today as much as possible to taste whatever you see, because I want you to get how powerful my food is and how delicious it tastes and how over the top amazing. So nasturtiums are really nice in salads, if you didn't know that. Yeah, because they're very attractive against the green. And I want you all to go over there and pick a flower and eat it, because you're gonna be amazed. It's kind of peppery, but when you finish, it's gonna be sweet. Everybody do it. Go on, there's lots of flowers. Just pick a flower and eat it.
Compared to mine at home.
Yeah, do it. And
I had them by my front door, but I've never eaten one.
Eat one. Now, as you're eating this, you can talk about it. Peppery.
Peppery, yeah.
But you see, when it finishes, it's sweet. You see that? Mm-hmm. At the end, it's sweet.
It is good.
It's very good. Mm-hmm. The Creator didn't make bad stuff. He's really good.
I can feel the sweetness now.
The whole thing.
Now can I tell you? I want to be real to you. How brain dead I am. You know how the assertions got here. My wife's been bugging me to plant them like in the garden because she loves them in the salad because she's artistic, and in a green salad, those colors really make your salad look cool. It's really like, yeah, and then they're quite flavorful. And so I'm talking to God. I says, now God, my wife wants to plant these in the garden, but I don't want to plant them because in the garden because they spread. If you notice, they just spread all over the place. And so I says, where can I plant them down my way? He says, well, plant them under your apple trees. So I want to be real with you. This is, I'm telling the Creator. I'm telling Him. Well, the package says plant in full sun. I'm telling the Creator. I'm just telling you how brain dead I am. He was really, he didn't argue. He said, just do it. So I did. And here's the heart of the Creator. You see, I was planning on planting someplace every year because that's what I do. This has now been 6 years. And when they finish flowering, they create seed, and they just keep reseeding themselves, and I will do nothing for the rest of my life, and I'll have the surgeons forever. Is that a good father?
Yeah.
Isn't that a good father? I mean, he really loves his kids, and he has these amazing ideas, and here I'm trying to talk him out of it. Oh, you can't do that. The package is planting full sun, and I'm just enjoying how nice things are growing under my trees. I mean, I've seen in people's yards where they're watering and fertilizing, they look this good, and these are under my trees. With no attention. I'm just saying, yay, God. God's awesome. He's just the best. And it's so cool to finally wake up and just start asking and listening and not argue because He has great ideas. Let's walk down here and let me show you about. Now, if you go to school, you go to college, you know, college like university, and you study agriculture and you pay big money and go in debt to pay it back, they'll tell you that wood products tie up nitrogen and make your soil acidic.
Yeah.
That's what you're told in school. Mm-hmm. I want you to help me discover the nitrogen type I'm having here. I need help, because nitrogen makes things green.
Yeah.
And I just don't see anything getting any greener than that.
Right. No, that's green.
That's like over the, that's way better than the stuff that they're doing with Roundup. Yeah. I mean, not Roundup, but Miracle-Gro. It's really all the same, but I'm just telling you, nitrogen type is ridiculous. Look how green it is. Uh-huh. And let's talk about the pH, the acid. This is really cool. Let's walk down here. Does anybody grow hydrangeas? You know hydrangea plants, if the soil is acid, the flower is blue. If the soil is alkaline, the flower is pink. And you can adjust that. You can change them every year by adjusting. I want you to notice this one, that you have both pink and blue flowers at the same time. You know what that indicates? 7.0 perfect centered pH. And they're telling me I have a nitrogen tie-up in wood chips, and I have an acid soil. I'm just saying, the demonstration is just so loud in my face, like, come on, man, get real. And I'll show you the benefit of 7.0. We're going to get over it. I'm going to show you where I'm growing lavender, which is a plant that is growing wants an alkaline soil, and I'm growing blueberries right next to it. We're talking side by side. They're touching one another. And they're both thriving, and blueberries want acid. And I love nature. When it's done right, you don't have to adjust anything.
Yeah.
Because 7.0 center, and everybody's happy there. It's just so fun when you start experiencing the design of this Creator who didn't miss anything, who knows what He's doing, who comes from a place of all wisdom, all knowledge, and it's so fun to work with Him because it's so easy. No adjustments. No arranging anything. Just plant where you want, and stuff grows, and just get out of its way because it's going to grow well. And it doesn't need help. Are you familiar with the ginkgo tree? The ginkgo tree is probably the oldest tree that exists. It's been around from like forever. And this is one right here. I love the foliage. It's like a maidenhair fern. Look how beautiful that foliage is. You notice this ginkgos grow very slowly. They're very, very slow growing trees. You notice it's a multi-leader. There's three trees coming out of the ground. When I first planted this here, it was a single leader. And the power to my house failed. A rock must have nicked the wire. And so the utility company had to come in and fix it. In doing so, they killed my tree. My ginkgo tree just was dead. But out of the ground came these little suckers. So I saved three. And today I have a far nicer tree than I would have originally with a single leader. I so love the Creator. He is so about redemption. Everything in nature is showing that it all comes back, and usually better than it started out, you know, because it's just, he's so good. I'm looking for someone I talked to on the phone from Norway.
I'm here.
All right.
Just arrived.
Welcome.
Thank you very much.
I have one asparagus spear. And it's going to be for you, because you've come the longest.
I want you,
my asparagus. I mean, all my food is like over the top. And my asparagus has been amazing to have people sample. I have never had anyone. I make a statement: you have never in your life ever had asparagus like this, and I've never had anyone ever challenge me.
And
you're going to get to be expressive for the rest of them, because I want them to understand what you're eating, because it's just so amazing. Welcome. I'm so glad you came.
Thank you so much. Thank you for having us. Sorry we're late.
It's okay. I mean, you came a long way.
The ferry.
Really.
The ferry caught us off guard.
It's okay. You're here. This place we're walking on for years was a grass area. And the wintertime, my wife's a midwife, and women come here for their prenatals. And during the wintertime, they come across this stuff, they're all wet, and they get all muddy, just a real mess. And then I have to try to level it all out and mow and weed it. And I says, you know, I'm done with that. So I put it all in wood chips. Mm-hmm. And you see, as people drive on this, it's never going to compact. Mm-hmm. And if somewhere down the road there's a need for food, I can create one incredible community garden right here. And while these wood chips are sitting here, the soil underneath is in a constant upgrade. It's getting richer and richer, just waiting for someone to want to plant it in. It's just, I'm telling you, nature is so amazing, so beautiful.
Could you explain to me, when you began with the grass that way, what did you put first? You know, did you put cardboard to do this?
No.
Did you try the lasagna method?
You see this space up here we're approaching where the tree is?
Yeah, the needles.
That was grass all the way to the field,
yeah,
to that fence. And so I'm asking the Creator, I says, now I've been told that I have to dig this grass. I want to plant some cherry trees and have a garden here, but I've been told I got to dig the grass out. And I notice you don't use shovels. You know, the Creator doesn't use shovels.
Okay, yeah.
And I says, so how would you approach this? Oh, he says, just cover the wood chips. Just put wood chips over the grass. So I put it eight inches deep.
8 inches?
8 inches. I came back in the spring. All the grass is dead, totally full of worms, incredible, beautiful black soil. And I've had that tree and this garden for 17 years now.
Wow.
And I'm telling you, he's made it so easy. I tell people, honestly, I used to work so hard to fail, it was pathetic. And here's the insanity of taking out the grass. The grass is a green, organic material. It's like benefit. Why are you removing it? It's as stupid as taking money out of the bank. I'm being real. And here we're out doing all this totally counterproductive stuff, working hard to do it, not getting, like, just cover.
But if you want to speed up the process.
So paper, when it gets wet, lays tight to the ground, will suffocate.
Yeah.
And things without water and light die.
Yeah.
So that speeds it up.
Okay.
But eight inches or more, do the same thing. In a garden space, 8 inches are a little bit much to plant little seeds in, so 4 inches is a better thickness, and the paper is quite helpful.
Do you add any blood mill or,
no,
you know, or horse poop?
Listen to me. No. Did you hear what I told you?
Okay.
If you don't see the example in nature, rest assured you're being lied to, and it's usually connected to something you have to buy. Are you hearing me?
Yeah.
See, no one's putting down fertilizer in nature. And you look at these trees, you see how green they are? Decade after decade, century after century, and no one's fertilizing? Excuse me? Really? I'm just telling you, that material is this. And you look at my trees, how green they are. It works quite well, and it doesn't need help. In nature, where horse manure shows up, it's a pile here and one over there. It's not concentrated. It's really spread out. You know? So I want questions. So if a question comes up, please ask it, because it's not an interruption, and usually they're really beneficial, and it just opens up understanding to get you free. Because you've been lied to a long time, and you're going to have to do some erasure up here, get things cleaned up, because you're coming from a lot of wrong premises, and it's not your fault. You just got lied to. But I'm going to show you today that the truth will set you free. Truth sets you free. It's awesome.
Because we have the similar soil, we have a similar climate right now in Oslo, and I see none of my neighbors are gardening at all.
Because it's hard. It's a lot of work, and they're tired. I'm being honest.
No, they work very short hours. No, they're not that tired.
But they're tired of gardening because it's hard. No one wants to do this because it's just labor intensive. As soon as you till your ground, what's the first thing that happens? You know why?
Disturbance.
No. Nature is connected to the Father. It knows the ground is not safe uncovered. And it's trying to create a cover to hold the ground in place. Mm-hmm. Exposed dirt will blow and wash away. Nature knows that. And they're trying to put a cover back to keep it in place. I'm just telling you, man, if you pay attention, all of nature is getting it, knows how to operate. And it's only us that doesn't. And it's we frustrate them because, what's up with that? Why did they do that? And then what happens when you till the soil? You have sterile soil. You know what's in the soil? What's in the soil? Thousands of living organisms are in the soil under here. Living organisms. We see worms are the biggest, but there's mycelium, there's fungus, there's bacteria, there's all kinds of incredible life forms. All have their homes, all have their babies there, and when you till, you kill them all. You kill every living one. And now you have sterile, you used to have a living environment, now you have a sterile one. And you think that's good? I'm just telling you, if we think what we're doing and look at the effect, it's insanity. It's like if you wanted to destroy your place, you couldn't be any more effective than, you couldn't do it better than by tilling. And we work and we labor to do that. I'm just telling you, it's stupid. And it just shows how we're trained not to think. And this is after everybody drives on it. Are you noticing the bounce in this stuff? This material cannot be compacted. It's impossible because it's so full of oxygen. And what's the first ingredient for life without which you die really quick? Oxygen. And when you till soil, remove all the life force, and you water and you walk on it, what happens to it? It compacts and pushes out all the oxygen. See, if you go in a tilled garden, you're not going to bounce. You'd be just, because there's no oxygen. All the oxygen has been removed, pushed out. I'm just telling you, it's so, when you look at it, it's so like, of course, obvious. What's up with that? It doesn't work. Water is a really essential ingredient. If you notice, again, the Creator is so orderly. What's your body 75% of? What's the earth 75% of? All my plants you're going to eat here in a moment are 75% water. I love the order. And can I tell you something interesting? I grew up in Los Angeles, California, which is a desert. It's very hot there, and there's no water. Back in the 50s when I was growing up, water bottles did not exist. There was no such thing as a water bottle. And we're out working all day long, 100 degree temperature, and we're fine, we're hydrated. Because back then, plants were growing in soil, they had roots, and there was water in our food, and we're hydrated with the food we're eating. Today, in Seattle, where it rains a lot, people are drinking water with their meals because the food you buy has no water in it. Because the plants have no roots, and they can't take up water. You buy an apple today, the thing's featherweight. It's totally like, there's nothing in it. You see all my trees? If you looked at them closely, you've never in your life seen apple trees that look like that. Anywhere in the world. You know why the branches are all bent over?
Yes.
You can't prune a bend. They're bent over because the apples are so heavy with water minerals, it bends the branches down. It's weight. I hand people an apple, their hand just drops. They can't believe how heavy it is because it's minerals and water, which are heavy. And see, all the stuff you buy in the store is totally lightweight because there's nothing in it.
You keep it through the winter.
I'm eating, I have an apple for breakfast every morning, and that's all I have all day long. I've eaten nothing since that. I'll go all day long with full energy because it's nutrient dense. Listen to me, when you have nutrient dense food, you don't need a lot. You don't need a lot. And this is why people are eating all the time now, because they're hungry. Because the body says, what you just fed wasn't food. That doesn't feed my cells. And you're always eating because you're hungry, because the food isn't food. And your body's not stupid. When you eat nutrient-dense stuff, I'm amazed how little I eat. How little I eat, because I don't need much because it's so potent with nutrients. It's so fun. I just give you an example. I grow these beets. We're gonna have you guys are gonna get to eat raw beets here. And you are gonna blow your mind, literally, at how tender and sweet and good it is, raw. And so I'm growing these beets in my garden, so I pick one for dinner, and I thought I'd eat it. But the first night, I was full on the foliage, the greens, totally satisfied, like, I'm done. The next night, I cut it in two, and that was my meal. The third night, I finished the other half. It took me three nights to eat one beet, and I got this long row. I'm just telling you, man, it is so fun. The abundance, the overwhelming abundance that you have in this kind of environment, and the whole idea of shortage is completely unrealistic when you have nutrients. It's impossible to have a shortage. Now, does everybody know where I live?
We do now.
I'm 530 feet above sea level in western Washington, where figs don't grow. Figs grow in Mediterranean climates, in places like California and Florida. They do not grow in western Washington. And I want you to notice the abundance of figs I have.
Wow.
They get ripe every year. So if anybody here's in western Washington want a fig tree, you see those little suckers coming out of the ground, if you go to, when you get ready to leave, go down, break them off, go and plant it, bury the whole thing. This tree you're seeing was one of those suckers 4 years ago.
Wow.
Right. 4 years ago, that was a sucker. It's amazing how well they produce and fast. And you see those grapes over there? That's another thing you don't grow here. Grapes don't grow here. It's so fun doing stuff they say you can't. These are strawberries. And this was 12 plants last year, and I've given boxes away. I mean, it's taken over, and people have taken all kinds of boxes out of here. You know, you can see the deer are much in the tops of, you know, and this hasn't been watered this year yet. Now, are there any gardeners here who pull weeds? Come here. Someone go pull that dandelion out, and everybody watch them do it. Get around the base and just pull straight up and just...
Oh my God.
Did you hear that? They're hard to pull out.
It just slid right out.
Are you loving it?
I am loving it.
This is how it's supposed to be.
I fight them at
home. That's why I say get a gardener, because this is not your normal experience. You can eat it. It's very good.
Wow.
Isn't that awesome?
Yeah.
And that's the beauty of this stuff. There's another one. Someone didn't believe her. There's one right there. Go pull it. See that dandelion right there?
Go ahead. See
that big green thing there? Go pull it. Pull it out.
Pull
and watch
out.
How easy it is.
Easy or hard? Wow.
Isn't that fun?
And you got the whole thing. It didn't break.
Now. Asparagus. Everybody should grow asparagus. Everyone. It's the easiest plant to grow, and it's perennial. You see, right now it's finished, and so it's going to seed, creating these ferns, and they're quite attractive in a garden, but make sure you plant them on borders and edges. Don't put them in the center of your garden, because all summer long this is growing, and it'll be in your way, so put them on edges. When you go to harvest, people don't know how to harvest asparagus, and they go break them off at the top, snap them off, and they don't come back. So you want to go down to the bottom, and break it off at the crown. Now, where's my friend?
Right behind you.
Oh. Come here. Now, I want you to be very expressive.
That looks pretty big.
No, you're not going to eat it all because this bottom. But what I want you to see something when I do this. Watch the bottom of this.
Oh my God!
You see the water dripping out? Now you know from your experience eating asparagus that this is going to be tough and stringy.
I usually have to peel it.
I want you to start here and eat it and talk to us. Talk to us.
It's really subtle. I do
here.
Asian cooking.
Uh-huh.
I cook with asparagus a lot, and I always have to peel almost all the way to the, you know, to the tip, just to remove the toughness of it. Oh, this is so good.
That's for you.
Thank you.
No, that's... It's for you.
No, no, no.
You get all of it.
No, no.
Listen, you're good.
Yeah. I feel so selfish, but I broke it off.
Yeah, sure. Yeah.
Now, have you had anything like this before?
No, I haven't. No, I haven't.
And I want you all to see, this is the norm. This is how it's supposed to be. I'm doing nothing weird. No fertilizer. No effort. Just a matter of wood chips laying on the ground that they're growing in. Being supported, and it's that good.
Why do you let it go to flower?
You have to, because you see,
no.
The plant,
yeah.
The crown has to be supported, and after it puts out all these shoots, being, you know, getting life.
Oh,
you see that spear coming up like this?
Yeah.
There's no way to get photosynthesis. There's no leaves.
Oh.
And so nothing's going back into the plant. So when it creates all this fruit, it's taking in photosynthesis, getting life from the sun.
Oh, it's recycling.
And so it's building itself, and so all summer long, you gotta look and see it's creating seeds. See these little seeds here?
Yeah.
That's all seed happening. And so this has to happen also because that's supporting and building the crown for next year's growth.
I see. And do you save the seeds?
No, just they just fall on the ground. I have.
Does it just
reseed itself? It
reseeds itself.
Oh. And let me just tell you the challenge I have. I have this row here, and I have one over there under my tree. See, I'm planting now. I planted asparagus under my apple trees in full shade. Behind a building that takes all the afternoon sun. I'm doing all the things they say you can't do, and it's totally thriving. Totally awesome. And so I have that bed, this one up by the house, and in April, when this stuff comes on, every 2 days I have a 4-quart pot full, every other day. And so by June I'm getting a little bit tired of it, you know, so I eat other things, but I'm just saying the production, the abundance is just like totally incredible.
Are you doing that just to be a bit rebellious, just to kind of test your theory about where...
Theory?
Not theory, but... sorry.
It's okay.
But just to test where you can grow, the idea of
I was raised in a Swiss-German culture.
Yeah.
And I think that German part of me just loves doing things they say you can't.
Yeah.
There's something about that that just like attracts my attention. Oh, I can't? Really?
Yeah.
So I'm motivated to do things you can't because it's just fun.
Yeah.
And what I'm seeing in nature, there aren't any can'ts. And what I'm getting is to see all the stuff we're taught in school, track with me, is coming from a default premise where you've got a depleted soil that's been mined and ruined and they're trying to fix. Nothing in nature is broken and it doesn't need to be fixed. It's just huge. It's really huge. You're going to see in a moment, we're going to walk. I have strawberry plants growing under that cherry tree in full shade. We're talking like total shade that are so lush and green. Excuse me?
Before you leave the asparagus, when do you cut it down?
In the winter, when it turns all brown,
okay.
I don't cut it down. I break it off at the crown.
Okay.
And can I tell you something? For those of you who like asparagus, you take this one home to you because you never heard this one before. This is an accident I had one day. I have asparagus bed over here. I'm going by in August with my wheelbarrow, and I break off one of these ferns. And I didn't want to leave it broken, so I snapped it off at the crown. I came back in a week, and there's total awesome spears coming up. And I'm thinking, like, what? This is August! And what I got was I just pruned it. I just stimulated new growth. And so if you want a fall crop, the first one row you harvest in April, the other one you immediately let it go to seed right away. Don't ever cut it. About August, start snapping them off, and you're going to have asparagus all fall when everybody's looking at you like, where did you get that? Well, out of my garden. It's just growing fine. I'm just telling you, man, nature's awesome.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Can I get two of those?
Excuse me?
Can I get two of those for someone?
Two asparagus. What? Asparagus what?
So
they
can eat it.
Oh. Do you see anything that there that's edible?
I don't know.
Okay.
One
yeah, oh, here's an awesome one.
Yeah,
yeah, awesome.
And then a baby one next to it.
The baby one is two baby.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I see another one too.
Oh, yeah, over there.
You
yeah.
send me the fall crop if you let it go to
seed. Initially, when it comes up in spring,
yeah.
don't cut it.
Right, and mine, we weren't around, so mine all went to seed this year.
So it's time.
Yeah.
You can start breaking them off like I just did.
I can do it now.
And you'll get a good crop.
Okay.
Okay, let's walk over here and sample some food.
Well, you don't yank it out.
At the crown, underneath, you want to break it off at the crown. Because
yeah.
see, everybody snaps off the top.
I
nothing
that
grows there. Back. Nothing comes back. But when you snap that off,
yeah.
man, in a couple days, another one's coming right. Because it's a pruning process. It stimulates growth.
Do you recommend leaving the seeds in that area?
If you want more.
Okay.
If you notice in nature, no one's planting seeds.
Yeah.
And everything keeps reseeding itself and growing quite well.
You were
again, if you just pay attention to nature.
I just love your comments.
It's showing you how everything works
yeah.
really well.
Yeah.
And it doesn't need help. No one's showing up to work.
I tried so hard for so many years to have a garden like this, and then I heard your message, and I was like, God, what am I doing?
It's so simple.
It's
so easy.
Yeah,
yeah.
You make me feel so stupid.
No.
When you break it so easy.
But listen, you got lied to. You came under the influence of a wrong source
yeah.
who doesn't have your best interest in mind.
Yeah.
So now you're going to shift.
Yeah.
Come under the, all of nature knows how to do it. So just track with them.
2 years I've been listening to your message.
Awesome.
Which is amazing.
Yes.
How long does it take to start asparagus if you don't have it?
You get it in spring, plant it in the ground, put witches over it, and you're going to have asparagus soon.
And it grows like January or late.
It comes up in April.
Oh, in April.
Let me explain to you the importance of asparagus and again the genius of the creator and the seasons. When does asparagus show up in your garden? What time of year?
January in the spring.
Not January.
Spring.
April.
Yeah.
What did April follow?
Winter.
A winter when you had no greens. And your body is craving greens because you're mineral deficient. And so you're out in your garden, planting your garden because you're hungry for greens. Asparagus says, hi, I'll hold you over. Now track with me. Everybody who eats asparagus, when you go to the bathroom and urinate, there's a mineral odor coming off your urine that nothing else does. I mean, it's only asparagus. You know why? There's a reason. Asparagus sends roots in the ground 14 feet, not inches, 14 feet into the earth. And they're pulling up mineral content that no produce even gets near. And you know when it shows up in nature? At the time of year, you're the most mineral deficient. You think that's an accident, a coincidence? It's by design, and it's perfect. I'm just telling you, it's amazing. And if you look at nature, the seasons, when things show up, there's a reason for that. It's very, very significant. And here we're trying to do all this stuff in greenhouses and have the same thing year round when it's stupid. It's not beneficial. Let's go over here and have some greens.
Is your strawberries over?
Excuse me? Yeah, they're over. We had an amazing crop this year.
Of course you did.
It was incredible. And if anybody wants strawberry plants, over here by my cherry tree under the where they're growing, there's a whole lot coming into places I don't want them, so you're welcome to go on the outside edges and help yourself. They're going to come out quite easy, and they'll be really, really good. Now you see this, you guys should walk down there and look at the size of my onions that was planted in April. At the very end.
Have you watered any of this at all, Paul?
Yes, I'm watering now. I'm watering now.
You're watering now?
Yeah, because it's dry.
Okay.
How much water do you give these plants? I think we might be overwatering.
You can't overwater the wood chips. It's impossible.
Well, that's good to know.
It's awesome. Wood chips just solve all issues. You see.
How are you watering? Is it once a week? Or?
No. When I feel like it. And here, let me show you. Look here. Everybody, you see how dry this wood chips are on top of the ground here? Mm-hmm. You know why you have weeds in your gardens? You know why you have weeds? Because you're watering all the time. And so every weed seed that blows in is germinated. Because I'm not watering and it's dry on top, no weeds happen. But I want you to notice this. Look how quick that gets damp. Look at that. Oh, wow. That's where the roots are. And that just never dries out. I love it. It's amazing. Yeah. And you look at the size of this is all planted by seed in May. Look at the size of these greens. And I want you all to sample stuff. But when you sample, it's important to break it off at the trunk. See, a lot of people, because they don't eat stems, because they don't know they're good, and they're usually not where they live, they break them, but you leave a stump, it's ugly. But I want someone to talk to me. You're good. You see, stems, you know from experience, are tough and bitter.
Yeah.
You start there and eat your way back and talk to us.
Could I talk
this,
to you
this,
too?
This is kale. It came from Africa. I've never grown it before, and I'm quite impressed with it. So everybody, and this plant here is amazing. The size, look at the size of those greens. This plant here is called Holland greens, and I want you to.
Is it like mustard green?
I want you to check out this stem. You have never seen water content in a vegetable to compare to this. Bite into that and check out how much water is in that thing. Everybody, come. You guys can help yourself. Just break stuff off at the base because I want you to sample and taste this food.
Well, what is this plant called? What is it called?
This is kale.
Kale. Okay.
And it came from Africa. I've never had it before. It's a unique kale. Now you see that one there is lacinato kale. That one makes the nicest chips because it's a really coarse, thick foliage. The one next to it is Russian kale. That's my favorite winter one. I don't eat it now, but in the winter, man, that is awesome. It's so sweet and good. And see, this kale will produce during the whole winter. I have unlimited food all winter. A lot of it I feed my chickens because they love it. You know. Yes. Yeah, that's really good lacinato kale. Pick a leaf. Go get some of that lacinato kale, because that's really good.
Okay.
You know, they all have different textures and flavors. You know. Come on. Yeah, get more stuff here. Mm-hmm. Come on, everybody sample stuff. Now, I started that stem, and you know from experience, that's going to be tough and bitter. What's that like?
Delicious.
And it's sweet. Mm-hmm. See, the stems are as sweet as the foliage.
The flavor is so intense.
It's you know what nutrient density is?
No.
Intense.
No.
Yeah. That's connect the dots. Yeah. When it's nutrient dense, it's intense, but it's good intense, not like negative. Can I tell you, everybody listen to me. I want to tell you why your food's all bitter. I asked the creator, because when I did the film in 2011, it came out in 2011, August, I had people coming here all winter long, like in February, like tons of people and farmers, you know, all over the world. And all I had growing in my garden was kale and cilantro. And they're all saying to me, this kale is not bitter, it's sweet. And when I hear something over and over nonstop, I kind of sense I'm supposed to learn something here. So the creator says, talk about this bittersweet. He says, the plants are indicating how they lived. I look at my body language. The plants grow on hard, compacted soil. They struggle to live. It's a hard life. And they're bitter about it. I'm being honest. They're expressing their bitterness of how they lived.
Makes sense to me.
When this stuff here just comes out of the ground like, easy. It's tender and sweet. Now snap off some of that Swiss chard and eat it and just see how good that is.
Even the dandelion is, it's not super bitter. It's tender.
I'm just telling you, the plants are indicating. Everything in nature communicates, they don't lie, and they're telling you the truth. Those plants had a bitter life. This stuff doesn't. It's all tender and sweet because it had an easy life. No resistance. Isn't that Swiss chard good? Isn't that good?
Yeah.
Good stuff.
It's
first time I ate it.
Yeah.
I like it.
It's so, and look at all the nice colors. Mm-hmm. See how he had the reds and the yellows. And it's just so attractive. You know it's good for you, man. It's like over the top, like nutrient dense, like you can't get sick kind of stuff. When you eat this, you can't get sick. It's impossible. Let me tell you the power of kale, you guys. Everybody listen to me. This is the creator was so awesome how he designed food. You know, antioxidants, that's what's in fruits and vegetables, will take out free radicals that cause cancer. You follow me? Free radicals that cause cancer are taken out by antioxidants, which are in fruits and vegetables. But once a free radical penetrates the cell wall, gets inside the cell, antioxidants can't touch it because they can't penetrate the cell wall. But you know what's awesome about this kale? The phytochemicals in this kale literally go into the cell, penetrate the cell wall, and eat out, consume the free radical. I'm just being real. This is how the Creator made it. And if you're eating this kind of food, you cannot get sick. Cancer is such a joke when you think of this, how simple the cure is. The cure for cancer is so simple. Alkalinize your body. Cancer cannot live in an acid environment. It can't survive there. It can't live there. And so if you have cancer, just alkalinize your body. Cancer dies. It can't live there. And here you're doing chemotherapy and all these totally negative, deadly things that are killing you, and you're paying money for that. And all you get is eat greens and you get well. You look at cultures that aren't industrialized, don't have dead food. See, all your food, processed food, is acid forming. Everything in nature is alkalizing. It's so across the board simple. It's not rocket science. And because we're trained not to think, we believe the lie. I'm thinking like I'm chemotherapy deficient. I get doctors angry if I have to go in for a stupid physical and they ask you what drugs you're taking. I tell them, I'm not drug deficient. Why would I take drugs? They get angry at you. I says, I'm not drug deficient. There's nothing that drug has that I need. And if you ever read the package, the insert, you get one line of benefits and paragraph of side effects, all the way from nausea to heart attack to blindness to death. Excuse me. What I'm treating doesn't even approach that. And I want to risk that by taking this garbage and I'm paying for it. I mean, I'm telling you, it's this non-thinking process that got into us that we do dumb things. Don't get it. Now, let me tell you about carrots. This guy's looking at you see my carrots? You see how dense they are? And I'm not thinning, and I never will. Here, let's just talk about the insanity of what they told you. You went and spent money for carrot seeds, okay? You worked for that money, you bought the seeds. Yay! And you plant them. And because they're small, more fall than you want. And so you're out there thinning. Now think of the insanity of that. You paid money for this seed, and now you're taking your time to uproot and throw away what you just paid for? I mean, really, that's what you're doing. So in a wood chip environment, because the ground is soft, I never thin because of the carrots push themselves out of each other's way because they can. The ground's not compacted. And they're totally, I get all I want, and I don't thin. I'm just telling you, all this stuff we do is so stupid. It's insanity. You know, and we keep doing it, thinking like that's what you're supposed to do.
Yeah, that's what we've been taught.
It's lies. I'm just telling you, man, it's so bizarre. And again, if you were thinking with your brain, you'd pick it up right away. Well, that's stupid. That makes no sense. Let's walk over here.
Abby, come here.
A fan, yeah.
We're going to walk that way, honey. Just come here.
Now, listen, all you people hang out. I want you all to sample stuff because this is why you came here. You're going to leave knowing that what you've had all your life wasn't real. So I want you to really get that into your thinking so when you leave, you're not going to be satisfied with that counterfeit garbage.
We can take a carrot.
Now, look at that. See that kid pulled the carrot?
Yeah.
Bring it over here. Now, I want you to run that by your nose. Now, track with me. If you go to the store and buy organic carrots, there's no odor.
It's incredibly strong.
Can I tell you what's happening? This is a scientific fact. In 10 minutes, not 10 hours, after fruits and vegetables are picked, they lose up to 80% of the metal properties in 10 minutes. So, the smell is awesome. So when the smell's not there, something's lost. Something's not there anymore. So you can wipe that off and eat it. They're really good. Now listen, those tops, everybody hear me? If you notice where you're standing, there's no topsling on the ground. Everything's real ordered and clean. That's intentional. So don't drop the tops. If you don't, when you're done, you can throw them over the fence and take them to chickens, but don't throw anything on the ground. Because if you do, I have to come pick it up. Okay. And I don't need any extra work. But eat those carrots and talk to us. How's it taste?
Delicious.
Full of water. It's supposed to be.
Yes.
We're supposed to be hydrated. Water is part of life. And you see, all my plants are 75% water, just like my body and the earth is. Because that's the design. And all this dehydrated food you're getting is not normal. It's unnatural. Are those carrots okay? You may. Come on. Get you know, try to find a big one. Because, you know, they're young now, so you want to get a nice big one, but go in there and just pull straight up.
You got it. Thank you. How long do you get to keep your kale like this?
All winter.
All winter? The entire winter?
The whole winter with ice and snow on the ground. It's not affected.
See, that's what I want to really desperately to try. This.
Just do it.
Yeah, I will.
And just ignore everybody. Don't talk to people. What you're doing, just don't talk to people because they'll tell you you can't. And you don't need that kind of stuff. Just do it. Because you were here today.
Yeah, and you
saw it.
Yeah.
I'm not lying to you. This is not fake.
I just haven't seen it with snow. That's why I wanted to.
I live at snow. Snow comes here.
Yeah, I do too.
Everybody, let's talk about snow and why you can't grow stuff in snow. If you look at nature, and for where we live, if you look at like in Canada, at 40 below zero in Canada, what in nature dies in the winter at 40 below zero? Nothing. I'm being honest. What's dying?
Above the soil surface.
Maybe, but all the evergreens don't die. They're above. All the ground covers don't die. It's just the annual plants that die. But the perennials don't die. But in everybody's farm next to nature, when the ground's exposed, everything freezes and dies. Everything. Well, wake up, people. This is an insulator. This is an insulator. It insulates the ground. And I'll tell you about your carrots in the wintertime. So I plant a fall crop because the winter carrots are so much sweeter than the ones in the summer because when the ground freezes, the sugar comes up. They're way sweeter, way better in the wintertime. It's superior. And they're telling you can't do it?
So you don't have a hoop house, you don't cover?
You see, look around you. Come here in January and eat my good stuff. You're welcome. I'm just telling you, in nature, again, animals have no hoop houses. And they're eating all winter. Now, the bear takes a nap, but most of them eat all winter. Again, pay attention. They're mammals like us. And they're eating well all winter long. And dogs? Did you guys see my dog over here?
Yeah.
Tova, where's that dog? Does anybody know about, you know, Labrador retrievers? The age, you know, when they get 4 or 5, they start getting gray hair in their nose. That dog is 16 years old. And she doesn't have one gray hair anywhere on her body. You look at her hair, it shines. That dog is a vegan, and she's everything out of my garden year round.
You don't feed her dog food?
Dog food? You see, you went to school.
Yeah, you're right.
And prior to going to school in the Industrial Revolution, for 6,000 years, no one fed their dogs dog food. I'm being real.
I get it.
This
is funny.
And it was in the wintertime, my dogs come and, you're going to love this, my dogs come and pull carrots out of my ground in January. And people watch and think, look at that dog. I says, well, what's up with the dog? Sees me do it. I do it. And the dogs just eat them. They love them. My dogs graze the whole year. They just love my garden. And they just think how convenient it is. They don't have to wait for their funky dog food twice a day. Anytime they want, they just go pick and eat because it's convenient. And they have a much easier life. And you look at these poor dogs eat dog food today. They all have tumors.
Yep.
They have cancer. And they're just like us.
Yep.
Because they're eating the same garbage we are.
Yep.
Wake up, human race. Wake up. Yep. This doesn't work. And you're paying money for that trash?
No kidding.
Well, this is all free? I mean, can we be any more brain dead? I'm just being honest.
It's great.
It's incredible.
It's great.
You're going to see my chicken pen. There's no odor. When you walk up to them, you go up to the chicken pen usually, they're running to you, so they're trying to get something.
Yeah.
They'll ignore you. They could care less because they have so much.
Can I save this worm?
Yeah. Okay. All this stuff that you, if you can save, take them to the chickens, otherwise throw the fences. Don't lay on the ground. Chickens will totally love it. Yes.
So you said you can't overwater, but how much should you be watering just to get it?
If plants look like at the end of the day, now see, like that's a little bit wilted now because it's hot, but by the end of the day, they won't be wilted. So at the end of the day, if the plants are wilted, they're saying, I'm thirsty. Mm-hmm. Or if avids show up, see now listen, bugs will only attack dehydrated, stressed plants. They will never attack a healthy plant. Everybody hear me. I want to adjust your thinking about what you're told in school. See, I went to the same school you did, and they told me that insects were pests. They tell you that in your school? But I'm looking at the Creator, who He is. His essence is love, and He's good. That doesn't line up with His character to create a pest. Doesn't fit. So I'm asking Him, talk to me about these pests. He says, they're not pests, they're my police force. I created insects to maintain a healthy environment. And what insects do is they go around taking out stressed, dehydrated, unhealthy plants, so only healthy plants will produce seed and maintain healthy plants. You see, if a stressed, dehydrated plant produces seed, that plant will eventually become extinct. They get weaker and weaker. So insects maintain a healthy environment. They're taking out all the unhealthy ones. I'm being real. And so I have people call me, I got aphids. Well, water. They call me, I can't believe it. I watered the aphids. Well, here, you guys are noticing all the water content in my food? When an insect would bite into my food, they drowned. They don't want water. They want cells and fiber. So they have to go after something stressed, dehydrated with no water in it to get cells and fiber. They're not going to get it here. Look at those cabbage leaves. Look how clean they are and awesome. No bugs biting into that because it's so full of water. Now, if you are a healthy bug and you're looking at that, you're thinking like, that's good food. But they don't come there because you can see they take a bite here and there, but they leave because they don't get any food. They're getting water. So they go after something dehydrated, stress dehydrated to eat. You know, it's so basic when you start paying attention. It's so obvious. It's so like, duh, of course. And it's so amazing how, because we're not looking, we believe all these stupid lies. And here's the insanity of insecticides. Insecticides don't kill insects. It's only temporary. Next generation overcomes it. They build immunity because they're powerful. And it doesn't last. Just like antibiotics. You got it. Because everything in nature is connected to the Father, whose seed is in it, and they're indestructible. They're all about overcoming and being surviving. And nature, and these stupid chemical companies don't get it. You're not gonna destroy insects. They overcome. And I love Monsanto's genetically modified corn is now being eaten by insects because that Roundup isn't effective. I mean, that stuff they have in it isn't affecting them because they got stronger. And when they're gonna wake up and get, you ever notice, if you pay attention to history, prior to 1948, when chemical fertilizers came on, yes?
Are chickens very healthy?
You're going to see them for a minute when you show up and you tell me. Before 1948, when chemical fertilizers came on the scene, insects never attacked plant life. You lost a few every now and then, but not whole crops. It never happened before. But when chemical fertilizers came on, whole crops were being taken out by insects because the plants were weak. The chemicals weren't providing their nutrition, no minerals. And because they're weak, insects took them out. And so instead of the agriculture community waking up like this doesn't work, they started trying to kill insects. And the insecticides got so potent, they were killing the plants. So now they put the insecticide in the plants, genetically modified organisms. And that's not working, but it's killing all of us. You know, we're all sick. I'm just telling you, man, it's insanity. It's evil. And we've got to wake up, man, that this influence we're getting is not to our best interest.
What about a moth that eats cabbages?
Oh, these questions are so cool. I had cabbage root maggots. They lay an egg, and the maggots eat the roots. And so when I was tilling my ground, my soil, every year I planted a fall crop of cabbage or broccoli. It get full size, totally heads would develop, and all of a sudden just wilt and die because all roots are gone. So when I started doing wood chips, it was so awesome. I tell you, I guess this Creator really, really is good to me because He gives me these amazing demonstrations. So I was so freaked out about losing my good garden, I only did half of it in wood chips. Are you hearing me?
Uh-huh.
I just can't lose my good garden. So we had planted these roll carrots and these squash. Well, the squash grew so well, it buried the carrots. So my son and I got all the squash out. And I noticed I had this space, and so I went and thinned my broccoli and I planted it in the wood chips. What was so cool, the stuff I left in the soil, as usual, when they headed up, all wilted and died, but the stuff in the wood chips didn't. And so I asked the creator, when he told me, when the moth flew over those wood chips, he kept going because that's a hard place to penetrate, to get into. He can't get into it. Where this is exposed, easy access, that isn't. I'm just telling you, man, I love nature. It's so profound how it's designed. And it's so built in, these amazing issues that just solve all problems. And when you take the cover off, you create all these problems. And then you're out trying to kill them when they're not a problem. Just put the cover back and they're not there. Let me tell you about this amazing revelation about that really woke me up to how all of nature is connected to the Father and in communication one with another. I'm growing celery in my garden. Ever plant celery seed, anybody? Celery seed is like microscopic. It's like dust. It's like a third the size, half the size of like celery seed. It's tiny. And so you drop one three-fall, so they come in too thick. There's no way to get them properly spaced. It's impossible. What's this?
Do you need it?
No, I'm fine. And so I got all these really healthy celery plants coming up too tight. I'm thinking like, I'm gonna throw those away. So I'm pulling them up. And so I'm gonna plant my herb garden. Now in my herb garden, I've never seen a slug. They don't go there. So I went and took up all this celery, and because I bare rooted, it was stressed. So I plant my herb garden, all wilts over because it was transplant stress. Come back the next day and my whole herb garden is covered with slugs chewing down my celery. So I asked the creator, he says, talk to me. He says, just watch. He always does that. He says, just watch. And so I says, okay. Come back the second day and all the foliage is off my celery. They're stumps. And he says, I asked him, tell me to keep watching. Come back the third day and the slugs are all gone. And they grew back from the stumps and did really well. Here's what he told me. When you move those plants, they put out a signal. I'm stressed. I'm dying. Take me out. And all the slugs who had never been to my herb garden heard it and cooperated. And then he told me this. Did you notice where you planted your celery in your garden that not one slug ever showed up there? Because those plants were never stressed. They never put out a signal. We're stressed, dehydrated, we're dying. And the slugs never touched them. And I got the reality that everything in nature is in communication one with another under the influence of the Father for the support and maintenance of a healthy, abundant environment. It's only us that aren't connected that mess things up. It's huge. It's totally huge. It's incredible. Everything gets it. It's so beautiful. You know, the design is so awesome. And here we're out there trying to mess it up and have things fight one another and do all this killing and damage when it's completely unnecessary. Totally unnecessary. See, when insects are attacking your plant, it's a wake-up call. Your plant's not well. You don't kill the insect, you cut your plant well. Same with you. If you're taking care of yourself, eating well, have a proper diet, getting plenty of rest, have a good mental attitude, you can be around people sneezing and coughing with the flu. It's not going to touch you. It's not going to affect you because your immune system works well. Same with plants. The principles are so basic. It's everywhere. And we don't get it. You don't treat disease. You encourage wellness. The body is quite intelligent. It knows how to survive and live well. So don't go taking drugs to kill the disease. Just get well. Take care of yourself. Because the body will correct. I'm being real. I'm talking from experience. I know what I'm talking about. I can't even remember what a headache feels like. Since I've been eating this live food, I'm blown away at how I feel. I'm being real.
How long have you been living like this?
Well, I came here 37 years ago to feed my family, but I did a lot of tilling at first.
Yeah, right.
Because I didn't know any better.
Right.
But I've been doing this for about the last 18 years. And I'm going to tell you something that's powerful. Your body is constantly renewing itself on a regular basis. Every 7 years, you get a whole new skeletal structure. Whole new skeletal structure. I'm 66, and with this cane in my leg, I fall a lot because I'm moving places where I shouldn't. And I go down hard on concrete, on blacktop, on gravel, hard, on my hip, on my arm. Nothing gets bruised, nothing breaks. And at my age, people do that and break stuff. Mm-hmm. And I'm telling you, I know I have a bone structure today superior to what I had 25 years ago. It's way stronger because of what I eat. And the reality is, this is so basic, people, you are what you eat. Your body can only create cells from the food you're giving it. And if you're giving your body nutrient-dense, really good food, it creates awesome cells. Conversely, if you're giving your body dead, processed food, it can't create anything but dead funky cells. It can't, I mean, even if it wants to, it can only make from what it has to work with. And if you're eating dead food, connect the dots, dead food can't produce life. It can't. You can't get life out of death. It's just not there. It doesn't fit the equation. And it's so bizarre how we buy all this dead food on a regular basis and think that we're getting something out of it. It's so across the board simple. And I'm just telling you from experience, man, eating live food is awesome. It's just amazing how good you feel. And the stuff tastes good. It's fun to eat, you know, and it's just like, it's so good.
The asparagus was, I've never tasted anything like it.
I want you to hear me. That's normal. That was how it was created. That's the normal. I'm just being real. I didn't do anything special. I'm not out there trying to make this stuff good to try to sell you a lie. I'm just telling you, it's real. I didn't do anything. Just stuff it in the ground, put witches over and left. That's what happens. Naturally. Without any help. Because it knows how. And it wants to. Nature really wants to be good. They want to. And they're frustrated with us making it hard for them.
I noticed you don't have a rabbit problem.
You see my dog?
Yeah.
You notice I have no fences in my orchard.
Yeah. Your dog.
Dog is awesome. Fences are expensive and they limit your access and they're ugly.
All over our area, rabbits everywhere.
A good dog. Yeah. See a dog, that's its home, and it lets everybody else know that this is my home, you're not welcome here.
Yeah.
Every night my dogs are barking because deer come here because they want my food.
Yeah.
And the dogs say, you're not coming here.
Nice. Did you get a smarter dog?
Did you already say, I maybe didn't hear you, why the soil is different here, the wood?
Yes. Now this material here is what's coming out of my chicken pen.
Oh, gotcha, that's right. Okay.
And we're gonna go over there and you're gonna see the most amazing soil manufacturing plant you've ever seen anywhere in the world. And it's deep, and it's unlimited, and it's all being created from my yard waste for free by my chickens. It is powerful. We're gonna come up to the garden, it's all part of it too. It's just, it's amazing.
How long after you put down the wood chips did you start planting?
You can plant immediately, but you want to access the soil. You plant in the soil, the wood chip. Here's the beauty of everybody track with me, because I want you to understand the science of wood chips. Wood chips are not a growing medium. They're a support to the soil. Are you all aware of the value of compost tea, how all farmers now are paying big dollar for it? Here's the amazing thing about these guys who are buying that stuff, how brain dead they are. See, when you buy compost tea and you water it in your garden, second or third watering, it's beyond the root system, it's gone. You gotta do it again. When you lay a composting material on the ground here, like this, every time it rains, every time you water, you get a compost tea release 24/7, 365 days a year, unlimited, for free. And gravity does all the work for you. Gravity works, everything goes down. It's such a simple, amazing, like, system. And you know what's so cool about the Creator? When do farmers fertilize? Come on. Spring. How stupid. Because they're planting in spring. And it takes time for that fertilizer to get to root level. You know when the Creator fertilizes? Every fall, He puts a covering of needles and leaves over the whole planet. And then He sends rain and snow all winter to create compost tea to build the soil for next spring's growth. And He uses gravity to do all the work. Is that genius? I'm just telling you, man, when you start looking at nature and see how it works, you just stand in awe at the wisdom. Like, wow, what an amazing idea.
Are you a vegetarian?
If I go to people's house and they offer meat, I give thanks for it, but I don't buy it. And I do eat lamb on Passover, but I don't make a habit of eating meat because, can we talk about meat?
Yeah.
Let's just be real. Okay, honest. What is meat?
Dead.
It's a dead carcass.
Yeah.
I mean, let's be real. It's a dead carcass. So prior to eating the dead carcass, they hang it to rot it so it's more tender. So now you have a dead rotten carcass. So you cook this dead rotten carcass and you eat it. Prior to eating that meal, you weren't tired. You were wide awake, totally feeling good. After you eat that dead rotten carcass, you sit down and rest because you're exhausted. I gotta go sit down. You weren't tired before you ate. What's up with eating getting you tired? It's supposed to be rejuvenating, giving you energy, not taking it away from you, but it makes you tired. Well, here's why. All the blood in your body is going to digest to try to break down and and compost, I mean, digests this dead rotten carcass, which is hard to do. And then when it comes out, it's black and stinks. I mean, be real. In our conversations, was there anything good here? I'm being honest. And can I tell you about, because I asked the creator about meat, you know what he showed me? It was amazing. His essence is love. Someone whose essence is love would not kill an innocent animal to provide food for something else. That just doesn't line up with love. And he showed me the first time the animal was killed was when Adam sinned. And because the Bible says, like, the shedding of blood, there's no remission of sin. So blood had to be shed. And he took the skins to cover them. But it was never his intent. And if you read the last chapter, when he comes back in the millennium, for the next 1,000 years, the lion will lie down with the lamb. Even the predators in nature will not be eating meat for the next 1,000 years. Because it was never by design. Never.
So, like, after the flood, when he gives them permission to eat...
Because there was no plant life.
There was no plant, so...
There was no plant life. And look. But if you look at the genealogies, prior to the flood, the average age was 933 years. Right. Average age. Okay. Oh, wow. After the flood, went down to 120.
120.
Connect the dots. Pay attention.
Okay.
I'm being real.
Yeah.
I'm just saying it's all there. The owner's manual is pretty clear. And it tells you how life works.
Yeah.
And the consequences of making poor choices.
Yeah.
I'm being real.
Yeah.
We were never designed to eat dead food. And here's the insanity of your schooling. Let's talk about schooling. You see, in the Bible, in the very first chapter, I love God, he doesn't wait long to give you your diet, because diet's kind of important. Don't you think? Diet is important. So he gives you your diet in the very first chapter. And God said, vegetables, fruits, and their seeds is what I've given to you for food. Okay? You were told in school there's 4 basic food groups. He says there's 2. And here's the insanity of the 4 basic food groups. They tell you get protein from meat. They tell you that. And you believe that. Are you hearing me? But if you look in nature, where's my friend from Norway? Okay. If you look in nature, at those huge animals that are producing the protein, like buffalo and cows and horses, you look at the size of those muscles, the weight they can carry, the speed they can run. Where are they getting their protein? Excuse me. Where they have the same structure we do. Heart, lungs, the whole anatomy, muscles, bones. Where are they getting the protein? Grass. Nothing but grass, 24/7, 365 days a year, and no variation, just grass. And they look far better than you do. I'm being honest, look at their hair, look how they shine.
Don't take a
look
at you.
No, I'm saying I'm better than I do. Forgive me, I'm sorry. I'm trying to be real. And then this whole insanity about getting calcium from milk.
Yeah.
It's insanity. You know what you get from milk? You get congested and sick. Mucus. Again, you ever look at a cow's bone structure? The size of those bones, how strong they are?
Uh-huh.
Where are they getting their calcium?
Grass.
Exclusively grass.
Oh, wow.
Can I tell you what's happening in my home just to validate what I'm saying? Last year we had a drought here, a significant drought. It was very hot. And so my produce grew excessively abundant, like too much. And so I'm having to give it all to my chickens because we can't eat it. My wife is complaining because she can hardly crack the chicken shells, the eggshells. She says, Paul, I can hardly break these things. And I says, well, Carol, it's the calcium and all the greens they're getting. They're getting so much greens. So I'm not giving my chickens oyster shells. I don't give them grain. I just give them greens out of the garden year round. And their eggs are orange, stand up, and they can hardly crack the shell because the calcium content is so high. So I'm just trying to connect dots and be real and explain to you how this really works, and that all the stuff you were told in school are lies put there by the special interest groups selling that garbage. If you got to get milk to get calcium, you got to buy that trash. If you need meat for protein, you got to buy that trash. But in nature, no one's buying that trash, and they're doing quite well eating grass. Did you hear what I said? That came after the fall, not by design, because at the end, the lion, carnivorous animal, will lie down with the lamb.
Oh, I see.
It was not by design.
Mm-hmm.
And my dogs are all vegans. My two dogs are vegans. Mm-hmm. And they're really beautiful, quite healthy.
And old.
And old. Mm-hmm. My point is that the carnivorous thing came after the fall. It was not by design. It was a default. And in Acts chapter 3, it says, God restored everything as it was in the beginning. And you see the next 1,000 years is going to be just like the beginning. And there won't be any animals eating. No one's going to be eating meat in the next 1,000 years. No one.
So I always associate my dog eating grass with him being sick.
Isn't that cool? When they're sick, they're eating grass.
Okay.
Because they know they need to get roughage in their system to get the garbage out, to clean house. If you pay attention to it, can I tell you about that? What you should have said? So I got sent to Vietnam to fight a war because I didn't want to win. I'm being real. They didn't want to win that war. And it was really hard when you're, 18 years old and you're getting shot at and you're killing people and you realize they don't want to win this. And they're giving us these sea rations. Sea rations are canned food, meat and potatoes and grease in cans. That's what they're feeding us. And at 100 degree temperature, 100% humidity, you're eating that kind of garbage, you get dysentery. That's the result. And when you're out in the field and there's no bathrooms, dysentery doesn't work well. And so I remember as a kid, like you remember, when my dog was sick, it ate grass. So I spent my whole time in Vietnam eating grass.
Really?
And I packed a 110-pound rucksack, an M60 machine gun, and I was totally well-nurtured, had incredible energy on nothing but grass. I'm being real with you.
Wow.
And I had no dysentery.
So maybe a dumb question then, when it comes to like getting your dog off of dog food and feeding him like a vegetarian diet, feeding him stuff from the garden, is that,
Talk to me about dogs. Dogs do what you do. If I'm eating a carrot and I give it to her, because I'm eating it, she's going to eat it. Okay. They do what you do.
Okay.
They copy you. They'll eat it if you're eating it.
Okay.
They're very, very easy to train. It's not a big... And what gets my attention is to watch them, how they'll go over to the space where I have the richest grass, and they'll eat that. They know where the best is. They're not stupid. And I got these pears. I got all kinds of pear trees out there. But I had this one called Clap's Favorite. It's not even ripe yet. My dog's picking off the tree. I says, Tova, eat the. This is my favorite. They know what's good. And they go for the best because they're instinctively connected. They, instinct is pretty powerful. Ever notice animals? They have a brain like we do. But they never let their brains override their instinct. Ever. Where we have a choice. We can walk by our spirit, which is instinct, or by our brains.
Yeah.
And when you go here, you mess up.
Yeah,
if you stay here, you don't.
That's why I'm still buying dog food for my 100-pound dog then, huh?
Yeah. So just start, what I do? Whatever I'm eating, I just make more for my dogs.
Okay.
They eat potatoes with me. Whatever I'm eating, they love eggs. Eggs is their favorite. Whatever I'm eating, they eat. So just make more for them.
Okay.
Can I give you, the Bible makes it, again, the Bible misses nothing. It gives a demonstration or an example of how dogs eat. Remember, Jesus is on vacation. He took a break. He's in Syrophoenicia, and this woman comes up to him with a demon-possessed daughter. She says, Jesus, I want you to heal my daughter. Jesus says, listen, I was sent to the lost tribe of Israel. This is not my place. And I love her response. You see, the Jews called the Samaritans, who were half-breeds, dogs. That's how they referred to them. And she made this comment, the little dogs eat the crumbs that fall from the table.
Yeah.
Are you hearing me? And see, Jesus saw her faith and was so moved by it, he healed her daughter. But she's connecting life.
Mm-hmm.
The dogs eat from the table.
Mm-hmm.
That's how all dogs ate. Whatever was left over, they just ate from the table. Because that's how it's always been. And feeding your dog's dog food is a very new thing.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not been good for the dogs. Dogs are as sick as we are because they're eating the same garbage. Okay, let's head on over here. Now, does anybody grow strawberries?
Yes.
I want you, as you walk by my cherry tree, observe the size and color of these strawberries growing in full shade. We're not talking like filtered shade, it's like full shade. Look at the runners coming off of them. I mean, come on. Check this out. Now, for anybody who likes strawberries, you see all these runner stuff coming out on the edges, you're welcome to come and dig these out and take them home because they'll come out easy and you got strawberries. And they're a very nice strawberry. But But look at the height and the color of this in full shade.
Mm-hmm. Mine aren't that big.
I'm talking in full sun. Yours aren't
huge.
That. It's in Trenton. And they're telling you in books you can't grow strawberries in full shade. You got to grow in sun. I want you to see this. I want you to start erasing the lies and start getting like, I got lied to.
Yeah, we're being told to companion plant.
Do I prune my trees all the time? Pruning is so essential. It's a stimulant, produces more food. Now I want you to kind of observe over here. The potatoes I'm growing in the root ball of my apple tree. These are potatoes, and they're growing in the root ball of my apple tree. I'm being real.
I see it.
This is where all the roots are. And the potatoes are growing quite fine. There's not a problem.
No mounding.
And you see, no mounding. You see the asparagus over there. You see how tall the ferns are. Under my apple tree, asparagus, growing just fine. The holes in the trees that some poor woodpecker thought he would find something, and he didn't get anything. Nothing there. But it's not affecting my tree. Tree's not hurting.
And it's okay to have the leaves and apples touching the ground?
What am I going to do?
Maybe sometimes people put a branch underneath
them. When you put a branch under it, a brace, track with me. And if something were to move it, because the plant's not strong, it's going to break. It's not an answer.
But they seem to be doing okay.
Seem to be. Excuse me. I mean, in any orchard you go to that are doing this for a living, none of their trees look like this. You don't have this kind of green foliage. And they foliar feed. They spend money to get this. And they didn't get close.
Your apples aren't white with spray.
What's that now?
Your apples aren't white with spray.
You see this asparagus over here growing under my trees, and you see this barn takes out the afternoon sun. So I totally tried to find a place which would be the hardest, most difficult place to do it. That's where I planted them. They're doing quite well. I'm having so much fun doing things they say you can't, because I'm seeing that there aren't any cans. Now here's an example of the challenge I have. See this young tree here? You see the branches on the ground because of all the apples? I mean, I'm you know, in orchards, track with me. They're all pruning the trees down, trying to bring them down. I'm trying to get my trees up. I can't get them up because there's so much weight of fruit, it pulls everything down. Look at this. Is this a cool looking tree? Does it look like a Japanese bonsai to you? It's a Japanese tree, it's a mutsu. And it gets 120 pounds of these huge yellow apples, but man, they're on the ground because the weight just pulls it down.
Wow.
So I want you to notice that in this environment, everybody hear me. You know why we have large farms in the United States?
Yes, because not everybody farms.
No. The reason we have large farms in the United States and Canada is because they're producing so little. They have to be big. I'm being honest. They're producing very little. And I want you, you're going to see very shortly that in this space you're standing on, you could grow unlimited food under all the trees, totally. You see the squash plants back there behind you?
Yeah.
What's so cool about planting squash in the orchard? In a garden, they take up a lot of room. But in an orchard, you just let them run. There's all kinds of space. And see, these will never be watered the whole summer.
Do you have deer here?
Yeah, dogs. I have deer.
But they don't eat your...
I have dogs.
Oh, that's right.
The dogs tell the deer, this is my home. You're not welcome. They bark every night. See this little tree right here?
Yeah.
This is its second year here. The first year it had 30 apples.
Wow.
30 apples. And you can see, I mean... Look at how the branches are all bent. I mean, you can't prune the bend. Those are bent over because of weight. We're talking sheer weight, man. Just incredible. And see my challenge is abundance. I have too much. And see, I prune my trees open because I'm trying to reduce the amount of fruit. I'm trying to reduce the amount of fruit I get, but it's not working.
What do you do with all your apples?
I have a walk-in cooler, and I'm eating apples right now I picked 8 months ago that are totally awesome, and every morning my dogs and I eat apples. And that's all I have for breakfast for the whole day because it's amazing food, and I feel so grateful. I'm telling you, honestly, billionaires are not living at the quality of life I do. They don't have asparagus like that. They don't have it. Even if they found someone that grew it that well, by the time it got them, it's wilted. It's not that. And so the quality of life I experience, this amazing clean air, the incredible water I have, this awesome food, is huge, huge. Quality of life, man, is significant.
Can I pick this dandelion?
You're welcome. Go pull that dandelion.
Okay.
Here, she wants to get that dandelion under your foot. Now move the witches away from it so you can get the trunk. And then watch how cool it comes out.
You gotta remember she's from Norway.
So listen, Norway's fine. Go off the other one, the next one.
That's a tree.
Volunteer, huh?
Yeah.
Now I want you to notice the ground you just moved.
Yeah.
You see, get in there with your hand. Go dig in your hand. You see how soft and pleasant that is? Now, I want you to pick up some of that and run it by your nose. Smell it. Are you getting that odor? Everybody hear me. If you go to organic farms that raise your food and you pick up their soil, there is no odor because there's no minerals. What you're smelling is minerals. That is the odor of minerals. And in organic farms, the soil has no odor.
Hey, Preston.
Isn't that beautiful stuff? Look at that. You see how with your hands you can move it. And it's full. And look, smell. Look at that. You couldn't make by tilling anything close to that. And you know, I didn't do anything here. I just put wood chips down. This all happens by itself. Isn't that beautiful?
Yes. So when your tree gets this many apples and it's...
Oh my God.
Are these branches going to eventually break at different times, or some of them? Or are you going to... So we got one fruit tree that it's doing the same thing, and I didn't know whether...
If you're concerned about it breaking, get some weight off.
That's unreal.
You know, just again, intuitive. Mm-hmm. You know, I've been here long enough to know this is no problem. But if you have a concern, when a branch breaks, it's not coming back for a long time. So save the branch by taking fruit off. Okay. Isn't that awesome?
It's amazing.
And see, after all the fun you did, you put it all back and there's no impact. I want you to get how incredible...
So
not jealous. You're going to do this. You came today and you saw this, and you're going to take it home because you saw it, and it's doable. There's nothing mysterious happening here. It's just flat out wood chips. Do all this, and I want you to get it. It's awesome.
The garden is so beautiful. It makes me weep.
We should, because this is the nature of the Creator. He's good. He's really good, and He loves us, and He made it really good. This orchard has not been watered. Everybody hear me? This orchard has not been watered for 37 years, ever. And last year we had a significant drought. No impact. Yes.
So these little guys here?
Those are suckers coming up from the roots.
You are not being gentle.
Apple trees?
Pear tree. I'm going to pull them all out, but unfortunately my son was helping me, and I have one coming up over here where these people are standing. 30 feet radius. There's one right there. See that one out there? Now everybody track with me. So you were taught in school that the roots go as far as the drip line.
Yeah.
That's as far as the branches. We're all saying yeah because that's what you're taught. This is a 9-year-old dwarf plum. You understand dwarf? You know how they create dwarf trees? They graft into a rootstock that doesn't develop roots. And because you have a small root system, that keeps the tree dwarf. Not many roots, it can't get big. And so they tell you, you gotta stake them. This is coming out, it's 30 feet over there. This is 25 feet radius in 9 years on a dwarf tree.
Wow.
And you know what I'm getting in my spirit? The Creator laughs. It says in Psalm 2 that He laughs.
Yeah.
And I just think He busts up. He says, I can't be dwarfed. If I'm living in a healthy environment, it's impossible to dwarf me.
Yeah.
I just won't be. And I love it. Now let's track with me. Here's why I never have to water. You see, if you had a root system going as far as a drip line, mm-hmm. that's pretty limited.
Right.
If you take this out and you do a circle all the way around that tree and realize that you have roots that dense in that space, you don't need a lot of water. Are you following me? Because it has so many roots, it can take up. And that's why everything you're eating is so full of water, because they have these awesome root systems. Because in this material, there's no resistance, nothing to stop them. It's full of air. It says, come on, move in, you're welcome. Get big. There's all kinds of room.
For that reason, when you plant an orchard, do you always recommend like being away from any sort of structure like a wall or?
Yeah, because it's going to move it.
Right. So that's why I was asking.
It's the roots will move the wall.
Open space.
Yeah.
So you have no watering system here at all. Nothing.
If you saw the film when I came here, I drilled a well, went 230 feet, got half a gallon a minute.
Yeah.
A half a gallon a minute is barely going to run a house with seven kids.
Yeah.
There was no water for the orchard.
Yeah.
So I went to the woods and the creator showed me how he does that without water. Yeah. And I copied it. Mm-hmm. I'm just telling you, man, it's what's amazing is that we're not getting it. Yeah. That we think that we can't do it. Because it's all around us, working really well.
Yeah.
And it's very simple. It's not like rocket science. It's covering. It's wood chips laying on the ground, you don't move. Building up every year, consistent. You know what's so cool is happening here? You know how long it takes in nature to build 1 inch of topsoil? How long? 100 years.
Wow.
In nature to build 1 inch of topsoil.
Wow.
And I'm looking at what I have here, the depth, and I'm thinking like, man, this is so, because by bringing in mass, I'm speeding up this process huge. I got like a lot of inches, and I haven't been here that long because I'm speeding up the process. So I'm gaining such momentum. Which is
see
so awesome.
The process by putting the wood chips
in? Volume. I'm bringing in a lot more volume.
Yeah.
See, in nature, needles and leaves do like covering. I'm bringing in like, you know, truckloads. Mm-hmm. So I'm just speeding it up.
Is there any kind of mulch or that you shouldn't put in?
Thank you. These questions are so cool. You see, I was told in school, you can't use walnut, you can't use pine, you can't use cedar. Are you following me? Mm-hmm. And you've all been around the block and you've all heard that. Mm-hmm. But I asked the creator, you know what he told me? He says, I have no landfill off in the universe where I'm taking that stuff you can't use. That's a significant thought. Mm. And looking at my woods back here, you see in the front there's a lot of cedar trees, mostly cedars. And you see those big Douglas firs going up through the top of them that are really dark green.
Yeah.
They're not yellow. In the summertime when it gets really dry, the cedar trees flag, meaning the interior needles turn brown more than any tree out there. The first wind in the fall puts all that stuff on the ground. No one's raking it up. No one's hauling it off. And look how green the fir trees are. Here's what the creator showed me. The tannic acid in cedar is real. It's there. And it's not ideal for plants. But by the time nature has gone through the composting process, by the time that material gets to the root, tannic acid is no longer there. Nature's cleaned it up. I'm just telling you, nature's perfect and it deals with everything. So I'm a slow learner, so the creator tries to help me. So I get this truckload, 10-yard truckload of walnut wood chips, exclusively walnut wood chips, dumped at my place in Swim, which is desert. This is in August, no rain. So I have a 4.5-foot raised bed. You following me? Out of the top of this raised bed, a walnut went through that didn't break. Starts growing.
Oh my God.
In August, no rain, 4.5 feet raised bed. So I says, God, you have my attention. You have my attention. This shouldn't be happening. I'm watching this thing in October. It's 3 feet tall, bright green. My brother dug it up. It had 3 feet of roots. He went and planted his yard. He's got a walnut tree. And so I got that walnut is a very fine wood chip. Things grow quite well in it. I just love these examples that you get in nature that just refute all the lies. You can't argue with evidence. There was no water. It was 4.5 feet above grade. Totally exposed to air, major raised bed, and thriving.
Wow.
It's just, it is wow. And again, it gets my attention. Mm-hmm. I understand now. I get it.
I found these on the ground. Can I eat
you
them?
Can, but you won't like it. They're not ripe, and they're going to be really bad.
Well, there you go. There's the answer.
You're welcome to them, but they fell off because, see, nature does this thing in June called June drop. And they do a natural thinning process.
Oh.
and they thin themselves. But if you look how beautiful those are, in spite of the fact they're not, they're still, they look really nice. But it's just that the apples aren't going to be ripe for a lot of months, and so they're not there yet. Sorry.
What you dropped, is that the tree knowing which ones just aren't coming along well enough?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Again, nature. If you observe nature, really nothing's missing. It doesn't need our help. And again, if you show up for man, if you look at nature, no one shows up to work, ever. And everything does quite well for the last 6,000 years of recorded human history. You know, it's so, when you get it, it's so simple, so obvious, like, come on, wake up. So my sense is for me to learn from it, like I'm the new guy on the block, I'm the learner, not it. I need help, not you. So nature, show me, do I want to copy it because it works.
Hair dropped. No.
Now you can look at these little trees. You look at the number of apples on these we're coming up to, you know. Yeah. And you can understand why the branches are bent over. You know, come on, give me a break, man. Now I want to show you, gardeners, something that's an awesome way to extend your plantings. You see that cabbage is over my garden, over that red cabbage? In that row were all these red cabbage plants, too thick. So I bare rooted them, I put them out here under my trees, and they told the wilt it looked like they were gonna die. But look how nice they're doing, under my trees. And they will go the whole summer here with absolutely no water, ever. Look real good. And what the Creator showed me, which is really awesome, I'm going to share with you because I just got this year, is that when I go to collect seed, these are the plants that I'm going to collect it from, because by moving them, they were stressed and they overcame, so they're a lot stronger than the ones that didn't go through that. And they're going to have a more powerful seed. I'm just telling you, man, I so love the Creator, because when you're paying attention, He opens up and shows you these amazing, and look how beautiful they're doing. And I'll never water all summer. And it's just, it's so awesome. And you see, out of that one planting, I get two crops. This was behind because it got stunted, got you know, stressed. And so instead of it coming on at once, I get these breaks. And so it's like planting twice, but not planting twice. Just moving them. Yeah, is that kind of a dense arrangement? Look at the apples on this little tree. It's just, I'm telling you, man, it's just like amazing.
This is amazing.
And this is without fertilizer and water, you guys.
There's got to be a dozen or more on this tree.
This tree's like 3 years old.
Wow. Yeah, exactly.
So you remember over there in that garden, all that kale we had? You see all the kale under my trees over here? I thinned the row.
Oh, wow.
And plugged them over here. So I want you all to look at this density that's going on here. And I want you to realize that if I had the time and energy, you see how dense this planting is right here in the middle of my orchard? You see over there all those potatoes growing under my trees? I could plant this entire space in this density with no issues. You see all that romaine lettuce? That came out of a row that I thinned. You see over there, that romaine lettuce is taking its place. You see how thick that is? Well, I got to thin that. You see up the front, I've already given some to somebody. So that's going to go somewhere out here. And out of the same planting, I get this incredible longevity, where everybody else is just throwing them away. I'm just telling you, man, it's huge. You see these little tiny zucchini plants? You see, they're already blooming, ready to have fruit. Because they can't help it. They're eating well.
That's their job.
They just, you see, I'll have all this stuff just strewn out in my orchard. Look at those beautiful shallots over there. Those onions, that's shallots. Look how thick they are. Look at the onions here. Look at my parsley. It's just like, yeah. And I'm not doing anything. This isn't being watered or fertilized. It's just stuffing wood chips and leave. It's so cool. put a plant. I stuck these. I took out of my garden, so I stressed them. Put them here. You can see the outer leaves are yellow, but look at the new ones coming on. You see one even died there. And so I'm in
pain. Did you start them with seeds?
I started them in the garden, so I moved them out here by stressing them. They're stronger. Mm-hmm. And you see out here, I'll never water. And they're not my way.
Are we still on 8 inches of wood chips here?
Oh, it's a lot more than that.
Okay. You just keep loading them on?
Yeah. Just, mm-hmm. Again, investing in the bank. Mm-hmm. At what point is that not a good idea?
Mm-hmm. How often do you do that?
Oh, that's a great question. I put this stuff down here 14 years ago, 16 inches deep. And I'm just now starting to put it back. This year is the first time I had 16 years ago, because that deep, I had a good cover. And you know what was cool? I put it right up to my tree trunk, 16 inches deep. And if you've been to school, you know you can't do that. Again, track with me, in nature, in the forest, when the wind blows. Needles and leaves bank against tree trunks because that's where they stop. Mm-hmm. No one rakes them away, and they're good. And they're telling you can't put up against a tree trunk? Could you imagine the irritants to try to make a little space around your tree trunk, keep the witches away, let all kinds of weeds and garbage fall into? I mean, these things they tell us are so maddening, so labor-intensive, and have absolutely no viability or example in nature. Wood chips are full of air. How can they hurt the tree trunk? What are they going to do? It's not dirt. You're not suffocating anything. Again, the stuff they tell us has no sense, no logic. And because we're trained not to think, we just, okay, we'll do it. Come on. It's stupid. And it's a lot of work to be stupid. I wish you guys, if you're close in October, these apples literally blow everyone's mind, because every single one has a unique flavor that totally flips people out. Usually when you buy apples in the store, they all taste the same, bland nothing. Everyone here, people say, I can't believe this. They just had one before. This is so amazing. This one here's from Japan. I can't even pronounce this. T-S-U-G-U-R-A. It's like, incredible. Amazing. And everyone has a unique, totally awesome flavor. God's not boring. He made things really creatively neat, you know? And it's so awesome to have all this variety and incredible senses of flavor and enjoyment, because that's the design. That's how it is. So you guys come over here. There's a few raspberries left. I want you to sample them because they're really good. They're on both sides, so get over there and eat raspberries.
Have you ever heard of an apple called ambrosia?
No.
No? Okay. It's New Zealand.
Mm-hmm.
It's my favorite apples of the whole world. Sorry.
If you live closer, I'd tell you to cut a little piece off your tree, and I'd grab it in mine, and I'd have it.
I would kill to come back here. I'm hoping to move here.
This is a beautiful place. The peninsula is awesome.
Yeah, I know.
I mean, you have a mountain range to the ocean. I'm 10% of the property where I live is private.
How did you discover this place after L.A.?
God. Okay. It was awesome. I bought this in 1976 as an investment. Never thought I'd live here.
Really? Oh, really?
Yeah, I
bought
it as an investment. Yeah. Save money.
Interesting.
Wow. You didn't know the plan.
Had no idea the plan.
Is that yours too, this open field?
Yeah. And those sheep out there can't get the grass down because it's too thick. It grows too well.
Are the sheep yours?
No.
Paul, is there any wood chips that are, that you prefer over any other, or is it pretty much the same?
Love them all.
I find they all work. Now, some have different, like alder breaks down quicker. Some things break down quicker than others. Mm-hmm. But man, they're all awesome. And I love the needles and the pine needles. They tell you can't use pine. Are so beneficial. There's so much green in them, you know. And see, when I was in Los Angeles, this time my parents grew all of our food too. We had strawberries, and the slugs ate them all.
You know how
I overcame that as a kid, and where I started getting this. We had a pine tree in our yard. My mom had us rake up the needles because they're in the grass. So I put them around my strawberries, and I found that the ground stayed damp, which didn't happen in L.A. Yeah. The strawberries were up off the ground. They weren't muddy when I watered. And the slugs wouldn't crawl across those pokey needles because it stuck them. Mm. And I had awesome strawberries untouched by slugs that were totally clean and thriving in nothing but pine needles. It was awesome.
Brilliant.
I'm just telling you, you know, again, it's so obvious when you get it. Like, all, if you notice, the most common statement you hear, well, that makes sense. Mm-hmm. Are you following me? What I'm telling you is so obvious. So it's not racking your brain trying to wrap around it. It's so like, duh, of course. Like, yeah, really? What's up with us? Why didn't we see this? Because it's so obvious.
What kind of slugs do you get? Do we get brown ones?
I get the brown ones. I get the black ones. Uh-huh. And I love them because if I have time, I give them my chickens. My chickens enjoy them. But I leave them in my yard because they never touch my plants.
Your chickens eat the slugs?
Oh yeah, they love them.
Oh my god, that's so good.
Really?
Mm-hmm. Oh, well, there's like a gazillion of them.
We have a lot of spiders.
Mm-hmm. But you'll find when you grow on good food, mm-hmm. they'll never touch your food. They'll go elsewhere. Now you notice when you come to my garden, it's a whole nother realm of beautiful ground. It's not wood chips. Those are currants.
Oh, they are. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Don't walk here because I got arugula coming up. And see over right next to it, I got cilantro. And over here, I just planted some beets and spinach. It's very different here because this material here was created by my yard waste, by my chickens. It's not wood chips. No, the chicken poo is so lost in the mass, it's probably one part per 10,000 parts organic live waste. When you get to my chicken pen, I want you all to clear your nostrils. Because when you go to chicken pens, there's usually an odor. Mm-hmm. You will not find any odor in my chicken pen, ever.
It's like ammonia.
Yeah. Can I tell you something about what I just said? Mm-hmm. You see, we were created as intelligent beings, and we've lost it. We don't act intelligently. If something in your environment stinks, what do you do about it?
Get rid of it.
You know that something's wrong and you correct it because you know that's not right.
Right.
As an intelligent being, you go to the store and you buy eggs and chicken that grew in a place that if you walked that place, you would suffocate because of the ammonia. Yeah. And that animal lives its whole life in that environment and you're eating it. Mm-hmm. Same with feedlots. That raise your beef. If you drive by them, you almost choke. The odor is just so gross. Mm-hmm. And that animal lives in that environment its entire life. And you're eating that? I'm being real. Yeah. And you see, the whole idea is you don't concentrate anything in small spaces. In nature, flocks of geese and wild turkeys, you know, herds of animals, there's no stench in nature because they're spread out. They're moving. It's so basic. It's so simple. And so in my chicken pen, I'm bringing in such a large amount of organic yard waste that their manure is so lost in the mass you can't even find it, much less smell it. And there's no odor. And so there's no fear of anything burning because it's not concentrated. So I can use it directly out of there with total incredible. Well, just look how stuff is growing here. Look at those cabbage leaves. Look how green and beautiful and big those are.
Did you bring the same?
Can you talk about your pump real quick?
My pump?
Yeah.
What do you want to know about the pump?
I don't know. Why do you got it?
Well, I had the pump.
Where does it go?
Electricity pumps water out of my well. When these unkind groups that are out there now who have the potential to do an atomic explosion, they're able to take out the whole grid of the United States,
yeah.
You can't live without water.
Yeah.
So when that shuts down, I have water. If you notice what I did with that one, I threaded the bottom of that thing with hose bib so I can run a hose to the house. So I don't have to carry it.
Yeah.
Go all the way down. You pull all the way down. Come on, brother, help her. Come on, buddy. All the way down. All the way down. Go for it. There you go.
This is heavy.
It's good water.
That was fun.
Now drink that water and talk to me.
How far?
Oh,
Is that good water?
Can I have a drink of the water?
How far down are you drawing?
130 feet. Yeah, so you're lifting water 130 feet. Water's heavy. But you know what's amazing to me? You look at our culture, everybody hear me. You see what we got told, the lie that convenience and ease is good. If you're paying attention to our culture, every generation is getting weaker and softer than the one before. I'm being real. I live in a community where they log here. These trees they use for lumber, and they harvest them. These 80-year-old men today that are really in good shape, they were cutting these trees when they were young. They were 4 foot through, 6 foot through, and they were cutting with handsaws. No chainsaw, a handsaw, one at either end. And at 80, they're still moving great. You see up here on the hill? Over there, they're logging. You never hear the sound of a chainsaw all day long because they're using these big hydraulic things that clip them off. No one's moving. And men today at 40, their backs are going out because they're not moving. Just running, you know, levers on a piece of equipment isn't moving. You know what? And you know what's so insane about our culture? Track with me. Intelligent, affluent men pay money to go into a stagnant air gym to run on a treadmill. I'm being real. It's stagnant air. It stinks. And they're running on a treadmill producing absolutely no benefit to anybody, and they're paying for this? See that firewood out there? I climbed that tree and took it out in pieces. I loaded my truck. I came home and split it. I hauled it here. It warmed me 6 times.
Yeah.
And I feel good about it because that's the most amazing heat of the planet. There's nothing comparable. Can I tell you about that? Come here. I want you to hear. This is a powerful thing about the Creator. Have you ever been in a house with a wood stove?
Yes.
If you notice where you're standing right now, how the heat from the sun is going through your body, through your skin, through your bones, right through you. It's thermal. The only other heat that does that is wood. Propane doesn't. Gas doesn't. Electricity doesn't. Wood does the same thing. So I asked the Creator why. And he showed me. Trees take in photosynthesis from the sun, they store it in their cells, and when it's burned, they give it back. It's the same heat, the identical same heat. It's huge. And you know what's so awesome about the Creator? That material is renewable. Nothing else they're using for heat is. And it's the ultimate. It just doesn't get better. And it took it in from the sun, stores it in the cells, and gives it back. It's the same heat, the best heat, the ultimate heat. I love him, man. He's just this awesome genius. These incredible designs he's made. It's so powerful. And you know what the most mineral-rich substance on the planet is? If you don't have a wood stove, you need to get one. Joel Wallach, guys remember him? Dead doctors don't lie.
Yeah.
You do.
I remember him, yeah.
This guy was a genius. And the government in the 1980s gave him a $30 million grant. $30 million, not thousand. $30 million grant to study the importance on minerals on human health. $30 million in the 80s. That was a lot of money. So he had money to travel. So he traveled the world and studied cultures who lived over 100 years. 120, 130 in good health. He found they had 3 things in common. The first is they had no electricity. The second is they grew all their own food, and the third was very interesting. They all heated themselves with wood and cooked with wood and put the ashes back in their gardens. Mm-hmm. He said the most mineral-rich substance on the planet is wood ash. As soon as he said that, the Holy Spirit reminded me my family was in Yellowstone National Park when it burned. We were there, physically there, and watched that fire take it out. They thought it would take decades for Yellowstone to ever grow back. In 2 years, it looked like a fire never happened. And what God showed me was when fire goes through wood, all that's left are minerals. Because minerals are not destroyed by heat or fire.
Back into the ground.
It's all that's left are in the ash. And if you ever look at a place that's burned, when it comes back, it's so green. Because it has such a high... And so he connected the dots. He says when our food began to be depleted was with the discovery of electricity. Because prior to electricity, everyone heated with wood and cooked with wood and put the ashes back in their garden for the last 6,000 years. and electricity happened, that stopped, and that input wasn't coming into the garden. That's when our food started going downhill. So I heat my house entirely with wood. All the ashes go in my chicken pen, and they're all back here. And that's why my food tastes so good, because high mineral content. So I want you to experience something really cool here. Does everybody like broccoli?
Yeah.
Yes.
Name of that doctor?
Joel Wallach. He wrote a book, Age Beater's Secret for Longevity. It's powerful. And it's all about minerals. Amazing. So I want you to observe the color and size of these cabbage plants. And look at the number of bug bites in them. There's a few on the bigger stuff at the bottom that are dehydrating. But I want you to look at this broccoli. This broccoli, you see, most broccoli plants, when they produce the first head, is really big, and after that there's nothing. Are you following me? Mm-hmm. This one here is an Italian heirloom. It starts with C-I-C-C-O. And this broccoli start at the stem and eat your way back, because you know that's gonna be tough and stringy, and talk to us. What's that?
A lot of these have already been broke off.
Oh yeah. My challenge with this is I have to come out here every week and prune this and give it to the chickens, because I can't eat it all. Start at the stem.
Okay.
And see how tender that is. Come on, pass this stuff out, because I want you all to experience this, because it's really good. And eat the leaves and everything, because they're really good. This is really good food, you guys. Now, you guys are eating this broccoli. Would you cook it? No one's going to talk to me. Would you cook that? Did you hear what I said? Everything here is sweet. Have you had something that wasn't?
Are you sweet?
No. I can be, but I'm not. Because I have choice. Yeah, pass them out. Thank you.
Is it okay I walk here?
You wait. Yeah, you're fine. Totally fine. Thank you. You're so helpful. I should have my pruners, but I don't have them. It's okay.
Would you let me help you with that? Can I try one?
Yeah.
Okay.
And you see how dense this stuff comes. And see, I'm out here picking it every day.
You know, it's the only vegetable I can buy in Norway on a regular basis through the winter. You know how much it is for 1 crown in Norway? It's $5 for 1 crown.
You got to do this. You got to do this.
You better move.
Yeah, sorry. Anybody?
Now, are you all connecting the water high water content? And it's not tough, and it's sweet, all of it.
Hey, Paul, I'm really OCD.
Which is fine.
Okay. How do you get your garden to be so straight? I mean, I see this on the...
I use a string.
Oh, God.
A string.
Really?
String is awesome.
Because it's so coordinated, so visually, it's so great to my eyes.
I was raised in a Swiss-German culture that trained me that everything has a place, should be in place. Order is very attractive to me.
Yes, me too.
And
symmetry.
Strings make things very straight.
Really?
Yeah.
So do you?
I put a stick in the ground, there. Both ends, and run a string. So I have a straight line.
And so you just go.
And then I measure three feet apart between the rows.
3 feet apart.
And it's good.
And you turn the rake over. I've seen you do it. You just turn the rake.
Make a little groove, plant my seeds, and walk off.
Who talked to you about making the documentary? Was that your idea?
Can I tell you about the documentary? Thank you for asking. Mm-hmm. See, these questions are really good. It's going to just show you how this creator really loves us all. Mm-hmm. See, for years, people have been telling me I got to write a book. Okay. So I've been doing this for a while. Paul, you got to write a book. You got to get this out. This is going to be so helpful. So I'm out here in my garden, in my orchard, talking to guys. I says, now, God, I'm not like these women you made. These women are amazing. They're multitaskers. They can be on the phone, fixing dinner, taking care of their kid, and they're doing it. I can't do that. If I'm writing a book, I can't take care of my garden because I'm focusing on the book. I can't multitask. So, God, could you help me get this out? Because it would be a shame if I died with this in me and never got out. And so that was it. So we used to go to this church in town, Calvary Chapel. The pastor died and the church got disassembled. So my wife heard about these guys getting together for a group meeting, you know. Paul, you ought to go. So I go, and this guy came from Gig Harbor, about, you know, an hour away. And he brought this guy from Louisiana. So I'm sharing with these guys in the group, man, what's happening in my garden, because I want them to get like, man, this is awesome. So this guy from Louisiana comes at the end of the meeting. He says, can I come over to your garden and see what you're talking about? He says, most of my family or friends are gardeners. This is amazing. Yeah. So he came and I did this with him. He went home and told his family and friends and says, Michael, you've got to document this. You've got to get this out there. This is huge. So he wrote some of his friends. They gave him some money. He found these two girls who had never done a film before in their lives. Mm-hmm. And they did this film. And you know what's happened with that film?
I would love to hear the magnitude that it.
The guy who did it never did anything like this in life before, so he's trying to figure out how to market it. It came out on a Sunday afternoon in August. In 15 minutes, someone in Australia is on it, and he got nothing but emails constantly. The film has been seen by multiple millions in 220 countries. This was 5 years ago. The girls now are translating into 18 languages because of the man. They did this video to get to generate funds to do the translations. They have this picture in Africa of these tribal people with this sheet over a tree, and they're watching the film. And says, "We wish we could understand what he's saying." Wow. I'm getting calls from people all over the world every day. I just saw your film. This is 5 years later. Are you hearing me? This was done by two girls who'd never done a film before in their lives. When they came here, they just got out of school. And they're telling me, we have to have a script. And I says, we're not having a script. I says, if you've never encountered God, you're going to encounter on this project because he's going to show up. And they were blown out at how this thing came out. And you know what's amazing? They've made a living, supported themselves for the last 5 years on the proceeds from this film. Wow. I have no rights to it. And my only requirement was, you've got to put this on the internet for free for 20 years. And I know what this film has. I want you to hear me. I make grammatical errors. It's not well done, but that film has God's favor and his anointing. Oh, yes. And the reason it's impacting the world, it's all free. And I get so angry at churches selling stuff. God sells nothing. Jesus never sold a thing. He gave it all away. And to be selling the truth and selling something you got from him is evil and wrong. And I think because it's free, people connect to the Creator, I get agnostics and atheists. It's all about God, and they have no problem with it because it's the truth, and the truth sets you free. It's just, I'm telling you, it's so fun. You know what's so hilarious about about who I am? I have no education. I'm a recluse. I go nowhere. I know no one. I have no cell phone. I had no computer, and I get to impact the world. It's just hilarious. And you know how I qualify? God uses the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. I just think he's so fun to work with. It's incredible. I mean, if I tried to do this, I wouldn't have the resources. I couldn't pull this off no matter what I did. I did nothing. It just happens because he's just good. And he's the best.
I was at work in my garden last year, toiling over this space, and this guy walked by, and he was walking down the street, and he said, you need to stop what you're doing, go inside and watch the Back to Eden film, and then come back to this. And that's what I did, and it was amazing. So
I'm telling you, man, this thing is impacting the whole world. Mm-hmm. And what I'm getting in the spirit, can I tell you what I'm getting in the spirit? The Bible says, when the devil comes in like a flood, the Lord raises a standard against him. If you're paying attention to what's happening on the planet, things are really being shaken. Everything that can be shaken is being shaken. And things are not stable. You know, if this film came out 20 years ago, maybe it'd be a few to watch it, but today the whole world knows we're in trouble. Our food's no good. We're all sick because we're malnutrition. And the whole world is attentive to this because the timing is perfect. Timing. And I'm seeing God is raising a standard to show the world how no matter what happens, I can take care of you. Here's the beauty of it. When the whole system shuts down, no electricity, no gas to go to the store, all stores are closed, nothing changes here. I get the sun and the rain, my plants produce seed, and forever I have an abundance. And I have no connection or no dependence on anyone but the Creator, who's really good, who loves to give, who doesn't charge, who's my dad.
Yeah. I'm
he's my dad, and he loves me, and he's very good at taking care of me. I'm telling you, man, it's awesome. And why you're here today is you're getting this revelation. You're getting that he's no respecter of persons. You can do it too. It's all there for you, for free. Really. You can go home and have all this amazing broccoli for free. No more $5 at the store. I'm just being real, because you just saw it. I'm not twisting your arm, I'm not lying to you. This is real. This is tangible.
That's how I found you, you know, because I was so depressed with the food situation in Norway.
It's so the whole, limited. My wife is a midwife, she travels the world.
Yeah.
And she says there's no good food anywhere in the world. She's blown away, there's no produce. It's all garbage, and she says there's no place in the world that has food. Like I pick her in the airport, she says, bring me water and greens. I haven't had any greens the whole time I've been away. I'm telling you, it's pathetic. The whole world is like this, you know? It's incredible. But you're here today to know that you can do this. This is very doable. And it's free. It's fun.
Yeah, it's amazing.
And it's
all. It's not hard.
It's not hard.
It is a little harder to come across wood chips than I thought it was.
Did you pray?
Just pray, huh?
I can tell you stories. Well, this is a Jewish woman that comes here from Port Townsend, doesn't know God. And so she's been telling me, I keep telling them to get my wood chips, and they tell me on their list. This has been 2.5 years. I says, now Robin, tonight before you go to bed, just pray and ask the Creator for wood chips. Say, I need wood chips. I want to grow good food. So watch what happens. Next morning, she's out in her yard. She hears this chainsaw going. Next door, they're taking this big tree down. She asks the tree service, and I go, oh, we'd love to give them to her. That's close. We're talking the next day. And every time she comes, I got another load.
Okay, I haven't prayed for wood chips yet.
And can I tell you something about when they show up, what to do? There was this young family who God encouraged them to get out of the city for their kids and move to the country. They bought this 10-acre farm. They never farmed before. And when they saw the film, it was like, wow, we can do that. That's simple. And so the lady's on her way to town one day, and she sees this aspen truck along the side of the road with wood chips. Nobody's in it. So put a note in the windshield. Another windshield wiper says, could you please call me? I want to get your wood chips. So they call her, and she's coming to the house. She's in the house baking cinnamon bread. The kids walk out with this hot cinnamon bread, give to the drivers. The last I heard, they got 34 loads, and they're having a hard place to find where to dump it. Guys like to eat. Are you hearing me? So when they show up, give them something good. They'll be back. I mean, really, it's so simple. And again, it's that principle. It's in giving, you receive. It's so obvious. Just bless them. Do something nice for them. They'll be back.
Do you donate to the food bank, or what do you do?
Here's the problem with donating my food. By the time I get there, it's wilted and no one wants it. I had a guy come here, and I gave him celery out of my garden. Celery is stiff. He couldn't leave. He's talking to me for about a half an hour. In 1.5 hour, it totally wilted over his arm. And I'll tell you why. See, my food is full of enzymes. You know what enzymes do? When stuff's laying on the ground, it turns back to dirt. If it's in your stomach, it releases the life force to feed your body. The food in the stores can sit on the shelf for a week and not change because there's no enzymes present in that food. It's huge. I used to get so frustrated. I picked this incredible, beautiful head of lettuce. I go to someone's house for dinner. I'll make a salad. It's wilted when I get there. It looks terrible. Thinking like, what's up with this? And God says, that's good. You should be eating it right now. Have you ever noticed, you're going to laugh, but the Creator never issued his first kids a stove and refrigerator. You're laughing, but I'm being real. We were never created to take live food, put it in the refrigerator and let it die, and then cook it and kill all the enzymes. I'm being real.
I love it.
You know, and if you notice today, you're eating everything raw. You're not having issues, and you probably feel quite good. You're not dehydrated. You're not drinking water. Pay attention to the results. And look at nature. All of the mammals in nature have no refrigerator stoves, carry no health insurance, don't go to doctors, don't get immunized, don't get vaccinated, don't get flu shots, and live really healthy, long lives. And they simply eat food fresh in season, period.
So what about the cooking thing? Is it okay to cook your food if you
It's okay.
That?
It's okay, but the challenge is that you're paying a price. You're killing enzymes. And so you're not going to get the food value you would have raw. So you're paying a price.
What about massaging it or chopping it?
You do whatever you want to it. I don't care.
I'm just saying, you know, the enzyme quality. Do you think that
the 10-minute factor. In 10 minutes, after fruits and vegetables are picked, they can lose up to 80% of their metabolic properties in 10 minutes. It's huge.
What does winter eating look like for you?
Winter eating gives me a break.
Okay.
You know my challenge is this time of year?
Eat as much as you can. Eat too much? More than you can eat?
There's times I can't even sample what I'm growing because I have so much I can't even get to it. In the winter, I'm down to potatoes, root vegetables, and kale and cilantro. I can stay on top of that.
Okay.
So it's much easier.
Okay.
See, my challenge is, not do I have enough, how do I possibly deal with what I have?
What is your favorite way to spread it out? Give it out?
Well, I give everything away.
Chickens. Food banks, chickens.
And see, that's the beauty of chickens. See, nothing goes to waste.
Yeah.
You're going to look at my chickens are eating romaine lettuce right now, superior to any human being on the planet.
Right.
No one is eating romaine that good. My chickens eat better than most people across the board. Really?
Mm-hmm.
And that's the beauty of chickens.
Yeah.
Nothing goes to waste. And then they turn it all back to this gorgeous stuff in my garden.
Yeah.
All recycled.
How do you prepare your soil every year to get ready for this?
Prepare it?
In terms of just, you know, just the way it's packed right now. I mean, it's obviously not at this level. It does break down, right? And so do you replenish it with your
chicken?
Your chicken.
People come, what I do, it works so cool. I get two people. I have two wheelbarrows.
Yeah.
And I have a screen and a shovel.
Yeah.
By the time the guy's back after dumping the wheelbarrow, the other one's full.
Yeah.
And as fast as he can go back and forth, it's moving that quick because it's so lightweight, so easy to work with, and so much fun.
I see.
Come over here and let's just put our hands in it and just see how cool it is. But I want you to, again, as much as possible, taste this food. See, this is parsley here. And I want you to eat that beet green and see how delicious that is. Talk to us.
It's really juicy. Super juicy, no bitterness at all.
That's a beet green.
Wow.
I want this parsley is such amazing, rich, you know, chlorophyll.
Is this Italian parsley?
Yeah. So I want you.
Can I help you?
Snap off a piece at the base and eat it. Start the stem, eat your way back, and talk to us.
Oh, God, it's really intense in flavor.
Are you seeing that? That intensity is saying, I'm nutrient dense.
Yeah.
I'm loaded with food value. And it's sweet. It's good.
How long did it take for you to get to this level? There, is this a couple weeks for you?
No, this is probably months.
Months, okay.
Parsley grows very slow.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Mine grows quite fast.
I live in a cool place. Doesn't get very hot here.
You could grow anything right here.
Yeah.
Anything.
Now, my friend, come here. I want you to come over here because you're going to love this.
Wow.
Come here. I want you to get on that and with your hands start moving it. No, get inside. Walk in there.
You want me to?
I want you to walk in my garden.
No, but it's so nice.
Do it!
Okay.
Now, get down and start moving that stuff. And imagine what you'd have to do to prepare that.
Yeah. I can't buy this.
You can't buy it. And this is, it's minerals.
Yeah.
And this is all created by my yard waste, by my chickens. Now, I want you to do something. Watch this, this is so cool. I want you to come here with your feet and stand right here and compact this as hard as you can. Just really pound it down. I mean, get with it. Now, are you watching what the soil's doing?
Yeah.
It's bouncing back. It's laughing at him. Now, after he did all that pounding, Go for it. Look at how that moves. Look at that. Are you getting it? You can't compact that. Now go with your hands and watch what you did. Move it. Is that awesome? It just never needs to be prepared. It's always available. Look at that gorgeous stuff. I mean, you couldn't buy anything like that. Nothing like that is available anywhere in the world. And this is all created from my yard waste. Minerals. That's the odor of minerals.
You know, yeah, it's sweet, earthy, don't you think?
It's earthy.
Yeah.
Because it is earth. It's how it's... Isn't that beautiful? Look at that stuff. Gorgeous, black, amazing. It's not chicken poop.
But I mean, it doesn't smell like manure that you would
It's not manure. Like I say, when you come to it over there, you can't even find manure. The manure is like one part per 10,000 parts live organic yard waste.
It's mostly like ground up plants. Roots.
Now, does anybody not like cilantro?
I love it.
Anybody not? For those of you who like cilantro, get ready for an amazing mind shift, because you're going to have a flavor of cilantro right now like you've never ever had. And before you eat it, run it by your nose. Run this by your nose.
Thank you.
And talk to us. Come on, pick some of this.
Wow, super fun. It's like fresh. Yes.
Oh.
Now eat it.
You know, I have to buy this every day because I cook so much Asian food.
Mm-hmm.
This is what I...
It's awesome.
Do you have this in the winter? Is that what you
all
have?
Winter. This grows all winter. At 4 degrees.
Yeah.
At 4 degrees.
How
this
do you
isn't
it cannot freeze?
This is powerful. It's not at 4 degrees, it's not hurt.
Wow.
It's fine.
You get this in the winter?
I have it all winter.
Is that the coldest it gets here?
Coldest I've seen it here is 4 degrees.
Hmm.
That's the coldest I've ever been. Isn't that good?
It's really good.
It's supposed to be. The Creator made things good across the board.
It doesn't go to seed?
It does go to seed. That's why I keep replanting.
Oh.
Very fast.
Yeah.
That's the beauty of the winter. I plant in September, and it gets full size.
Yeah.
When October comes, it's cold, and it stops growing, and all winter long, it doesn't go to seed, and I have awesome cilantro.
Amazing.
It is awesome.
Crazy.
Now, look at this, you guys. Let's eat it. This stuff is good. Pick some of these big leaves of spinach and eat it.
I got it for you.
Everybody, come snap off these leaves. Again, start the stem, eat your way back, and just notice the nice flavor. Come on.
I can eat a smaller one, but I can't eat it like that.
Would you like one?
Yeah?
That's yours. Come on.
Mm-hmm. I like to share.
Did you come out from Norway just to see him?
Well, this was part of the grand design, yes.
Yeah.
Awesome. I've been watching it for a few years now.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, slightly addicted.
Doesn't smell good?
Yeah.
Now, again, track with me. When you go to the store and buy cilantro, there's no odor.
Yeah.
You're not smelling anything.
Smell like
that. That's that 10-minute factor. You see, something's lost. Something isn't there. That's why picking and eating is the ultimate, ultimate nutrition for your body. It's powerful.
Okay.
It's by design.
No, this is spinach.
Spinach.
I want to share with you, I have a digestive issue. And I thought that eating some of the greens and stuff would really bother me, and nothing's bothered me yet.
It won't.
And that alone has changed.
And I want you to know that was your father.
Mm-hmm,
God wants
sure.
you to know you were made in his image, fearfully and wonderfully. There's nothing wrong with you in your digestive issues, because the stuff you're eating is not digestible.
Mm-hmm.
It's not food. And so today, you had a God encounter. He spoke to you and gave you revelation of how good he is and how powerfully awesome your body is. And there's nothing wrong with you. It's the food issue. And you have incredible...
But that just became even more apparent than it already was.
Yeah.
I was already going down that path. And like you said, just...
This is confirmation.
Yeah, for
this
sure.
is God. This is who... He's real. He cares. He loves you.
Know.
And he wants you to know that he's made everything for you perfect. And there's nothing wrong with your body. So he was talking about having digestive issues. I had a little boy come here last year on a tour, 9 years old, and he told me he was allergic to apples. Can't eat apples. I looked at him and says, "You're not allergic to apples." You are fearfully and wonderfully made in the image of God. There's nothing wrong with your body. You're reacting to the pesticides, fungicides, and poisons that are in the apple. And while you're here, you can eat all you want because you have no... You don't understand what I eat. I understand. You're reacting to poisons. They're not here. So just watch these people. Can you believe the fragrance of this apple? Look at the wildest taste. And he's here, and he couldn't take it anymore, so he took one. He's three quarters of the way through, and he's yelling at the top of his lungs, I'm not reacting. I'm allergic to apples. I'm not reacting. It was so awesome. So God always does these things in the mouth of truth. He witnesses truth. Next week, a woman comes from upstate New York, allergic to apples. She ate three back to back with absolutely no impact.
Can we come back in October now?
You're welcome. You should, because October, I'm telling you, my apples are... And so you young people...
They got caught up in the Frisbee game.
Mm-hmm. You parents tell them?
Yes.
You know what the future is going to be? If you pay attention to where the investors now are investing, the people with the big money, billions and trillions, they're investing in food and farms because they know the future. So if you're growing apples like this, you will never meet the market demand. Impossible. Dr. McColl in 2012 on his website made this statement, 12 things you should no longer eat. The first on the list were apples. And we're at a time in history where nothing in the store you can eat. And if you're growing stuff like this, that's just delicious and absolutely no side effects, nothing bad, it will be impossible to meet the market demand. Impossible. And you know how the economy works, supply and demand? When you have a demand you can't meet and a limited supply, you know where the price goes? Through the ceiling. So I'm just telling you, the future in live food, such as this, is across the board. And I can tell from experience, I have 7 children, I train my children to work, and I never gave them money. They want money, go earn it. So I have this daughter, Devorah, she's a real shaker mover. She says, Dad, take me to the farmer's market. I'll make some money this weekend. Take me to the farmer's market. You know, she has a brain, she thinks. So when you go to a farmer's market, you have to have a designated spot you bought, paid for. She had none. She goes to the farmer's market, sets up herself on the ground, and I'm watching the vendors come out of their booths and bought her out in 15, 20 minutes every Saturday. And they weren't selling it. These are farmers that bought her out and were taking her home to eat. I'm being real. I watched it happen. They're sitting there all day long and taking stuff home because they didn't sell it, man. But she sold out in 15, 20 minutes because what she had was nutrient-dense, amazing food that nobody else had. And, you know, you don't stand around with that kind of stuff, you know. Okay, Dad, we can go home. I got money. 15, 20 minutes every time. You know? So I know what I'm talking about. I've watched this happen. So growing food like this has an amazing future for young people. Tremendous.
I have to tell you, I love raw fruits and veggies, and for the last few years, I haven't been able to eat them. And usually by this time, I would be in the bathroom.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
This is just blowing my mind.
I just want you to know your father really loves you.
For sure.
And he wanted to encounter you today and let you know that he loves you. Nothing's wrong with you. He gave you a love for fruits and vegetables because that's what he made. And you can have them forever if they're growing well. There's nothing wrong with you. And I'm just telling you, man, that's his heart. That's his heart. And see, this is why I so love doing this. I love the... This is life-changing. This is huge. You were living under this incredible oppression, thinking like you couldn't have that stuff. And God just set you free today. You can have all you want, forever, unlimited, with nothing but good effect, because he made you well, and he loves you. I love it, man. This is huge. It's like, yay, God. Come here, I'm gonna give you a hug.
Thank you.
Bless you, bless you, bless you.
She wasn't gonna come.
So I want to show you this neat contrast here to show you that wood chip environment, you can grow everything in the same place because the pH is 7.0. So you see we're approaching this lavender plant up here. Mm-hmm. And you can tell that it's doing quite well. It's not unhappy, it's not struggling. And if you look right at the base of it, there's a blueberry plant growing side by side next to it. Here you have the opposites of pH. Yeah. Are you following me? Mm-hmm. Alkaline is what the lavender wants. Yeah. and the blueberry wants acid. And they're side by side thriving. You see that blueberry over there behind? You see it, that beautiful dark blue-green foliage? How healthy that is? I mean, come on. All your Miracle-Gro stuff would never do that. And if you look closely at the amount of blueberries hanging on it, the numbers.
Wow. You might be distracted by the snack, Dad.
Okay. Oh my goodness. Everybody get over there. My son created some nice raw beets for you. And I want you all to. Over there. If you see that fence over there,
yeah.
Go throw it over the fence and the chickens will come get it from
you. I'm gonna wait for everybody.
Isn't that good for raw beet? Yeah. Well, you saw it growing out there. That's where it came from, out of that soil. And you see how much, you know, my sense is it's so much, you know, when you cook them, they're bland, they're soft, they're just like, this is just crispy and delicious and like, yeah. Yeah.
On the fig, when you plant the twig, you bury the whole thing.
As much as possible. See, the more you bury, the more it roots.
There's a better chance.
Yeah, because you have more places for roots to develop. No, you see these figs? Look at the color of that foliage. Look how healthy those are. You know why they're here? Because they won't grow in my herb garden. I had a big one over there, and because it got cold in the winter, every year it burned back. But what God brought to my attention, I'm south facing, and you see this major blanket I have back here? These fir trees in the wintertime are a huge blanket. They hold heat in. And because these are up against them, they totally do amazing. And again, it's this whole thing of paying attention, observing, you know, how nature's made. And you have these little microclimates, these little spaces that you can do things that you can't anywhere else. And it's all that thing of paying attention, being observant, listening. And I made a lot of mistakes. Like I said, that was a huge fig tree I had, but I got rid of it because it wasn't working. But these, I'm going to plant another one right over there. I have it growing in squim. It's going to move up here because this is the most perfect place to grow figs. And they are so good. I mean, they are so amazingly good. Oh, and they're not even ripe yet. They won't get ripe till like October. You know.
Say that it had a lot of dense cattle on it that you wanted to turn into a garden, what would be your step if it was really just like packed down?
Wood chips over it.
Just put wood chips over it.
Look over here. Mm-hmm. I want you to walk over there by my house and check out the soil that's on that ground. Mm-hmm. You have never in your life seen anything harder, more compacted, and full of rocks. Uh-huh. And that's what's under everything you walked on here. That's my soil. And all I did was put the cover over it. Uh-huh. It changes it. I had a guy come here, it was interesting. He came from like Idaho, and when he saw that, he went over to my herb garden right here, and he started digging with his hand in my strawberry bed. He's down to his elbow pulling up rocks, and he's flipping out because he's doing it with his hand, and he saw that. He saw my cement, and he realized that all changed. She's asking about they have hard soil. If you look over here, just beyond that bench, at the soil that's in my yard, that is the most compacted clay and rock you've seen anywhere. You can't break it with a pick. And that's what everything you walked on and ate from is underneath it. And so when this guy saw that, he went over to my herb garden here. He's got on his knees, he starts moving those wood chips, and he's down to his elbow pulling up rocks. And he's flipping out because he saw that. He said, I'm doing this with my hand. And I says, when you put this cover on, the soil underneath changes. It's all being changed. It's just so, and see the reason that got hard up front over here, you see this was the forest where my house was. They came with a bulldozer and scraped all the topsoil off so I could build my house. Are you hearing me? And that's why that material is concrete today. because all the topsoil is removed. But when you put the wood chips back, you start, you know, creating a cover, and topsoil starts happening. I mean, it's, you know, it's so basic, it's so simple. It's like, of course, like, duh.
Yeah. Is this green from the bleeding off from this? This green here?
No, these three green strips you see.
Oh, the septic.
It's my drain field.
Drain field, yeah, okay.
It works quite well.
Yeah.
See, everything on my property is being recycled.
Yeah.
Everything.
Yeah.
It's awesome. Nothing's thrown away.
But the pasture, that's drain off from...
The orchard and garden.
The orchard and garden.
How old is that blueberry bush?
I found a huge one.
Which one?
This one right here.
That here has been here like 3 years.
That's amazing.
Well, look at those ones over there.
Yeah.
And look at the amount of blueberries on those. Yeah, those are 7 years old.
So these are your leach lines?
Yeah, drain field.
So then there's no problem with growing next to the leach lines, or do you have to stay a certain amount away? Or
trees.
I've got the same thing.
Trees. Grass.
No. Oh, okay.
You know, produce. But tree roots will get it. Well, you don't want to have trees on your drain field.
Yeah, but I meant like no problem contaminating the ground, contaminating your food source or anything.
Everybody come here. This guy's asked a really important question. I want you to understand. This is really powerful. This is my drain field right here. This is all the stuff coming on my septic tank, which is right there, that green plastic in my grass. So all my feces, all the stuff from my house is right here. When the guy came to I've been here 37 years and I have 7 children that lived here. We've only pumped our septic tank 3 times. When the guy came to pump it the last time, when he popped the lid, he freaked out. He said, I have never in my life seen such perfect compost. He says, you must eat well. And I says, look at my garden. That's what I eat. He says, this is the most perfect compost I've ever seen. This is amazing. And he's telling me that I can tell when I go to the septic, I can tell what nationality people are. I can tell what vitamins they're taking. I can tell what drugs they're taking because the septic reveals everything of that home. He says 1-a-day vitamins are at the bottom of the septic tank, the same color that they were in the jar. They don't break down. So all you people buying vitamins, unless you're buying vitamins that are made from food form, you're wasting your money because your body's not stupid and your body will not consume, break down something that's not food. Chemotherapy, he says the septic is totally dead. No bacteria, no, you know, it's totally dead because it kills everything. It's phenomenal. I learned so much from this guy, but he flipped out. He says, this is the most perfect compost I've ever seen. And so my sense is, because we eat well and we don't put garbage in our septic tank, you know, all garbage goes out here and everything we do is clean. This water going through here, filtered through all this material, is totally safe. It's not an issue, you know? Again, it's just, you know, everything in nature recycles. You know, it's all by design. Nothing's thrown away, you know, and unless you're adding something toxic to it, it's not toxic because everything goes back to dirt.
My husband insists that we plant in hills.
Here's the challenge with hills or raised beds. Because they're above grade, they're exposed to a lot of air. And when you're around a lot of air, it's going to dry it out. Your husband's going to water like crazy.
Yeah, he's like, water it in the morning.
No, you're going to be watering all day because it's going to dry out.
Mm. And I'm on a hill. Our garden is on a hill.
So what you want to do on that hill, below the garden, will be the finest stuff you'll ever grow because gravity works. So all the runoff from your garden is going to feed the area down below. So plant things you care about on the bottom end because that's where everything's going to be. Gravity works.
I'll just do it along the bottom of the hill. Just make a really long garden.
100% of the time, right?
Yeah.
Gravity works. That makes me think that
I want you to experience nutrient density. Now you see this guy walking in my. I want you to do this full weight. I want you to walk full weight on top of my plants.
On the plant?
Yeah, right across there. Full weight.
Why?
No, keep walking. Keep going. Keep going. Now, are you noticing you can't even tell where he was? Nothing got broke. Because it's buoyant underneath.
Like a
sponge. Takes up shock. Are wood chips amazing? Are they the best? Are they just like it don't end all the good? I love it, man. So eat that. Hey, look. Listen, all you women, come here. Use thyme in your cooking. Thyme, the herb.
Yes.
Take a very tiny piece of this, and I underline the word tiny, because you're going to flip out at how potent this is. And I want you to get the power of wood chips. Is that potent? No thyme you've ever bought in a store even approaches that.
Oh my gosh.
That smells so good.
Super intense.
Intense. That's called nutrient density.
My husband's a chef.
Wow, that's
I'm telling you, man. This is awesome.
What would it take to get him here? The same as my husband.
Now look. Now for those that got a little bit taken out by that thyme, go over there. Go over there and see that green right over here.
Wait,
that's lemon balm, and it's really, really sweet.
Your son's gonna fall out.
Oh, he's falling out.
Isn't that good, that lemon balm? Eat that. Eat those leaves, man. They're delicious. Isn't that good? It's lemon balm. Yeah, it's awesome. Now, everybody come here, because I want to show you an amazing contrast. This is where the scientists lose it here. Come here. You see this plant right here? Does anybody recognize what this is? Sage. That is white sage. Do you have a sense on how healthy this plant is?
Yeah, it looks really unusual.
Like over the top? Do you know what this plant is?
The violets?
No. All you gardeners that are good at identifying plant, what is this?
Pick me.
Wasabi. Do you know where wasabi grows in nature?
Where?
In standing water along riverbeds or in stream beds in full shade. This is in full sun, having no irrigation, growing right next to sage that grows in deserts with no water. It is wow. It was so wow that I had to ask the creator, because my brain couldn't wrap around the opposites of water requirements side by side. You know what he told me? It made me cry. He says there's enough airspace in the wood chips for the sage to hang out in the open spaces and avoid the water. But if the wasabi wants the water, and go it is, but they have the option. I started bawling. God designed nature in such a powerful way that you can plant everything in the same place, and the plants can choose what they want because it's all there. Wow. I'm telling you, man, it's awesome. And here we're out there trying to adjust pH, trying to adjust watering for specific plants that never lasts, when God just says, I made it so you can grow everything in the same place. Look at these blueberries, you guys. Look at the numbers that are on. They're not ripe yet, but I'm just telling you, man, look at the numbers. They're not ripe, you guys. They're not even good. Don't pick those. They're not ripe. I know what ripe is. This is not even close. When they're ripe.
They're purple.
They're not ripe. They got to get really dark blue, and they're not there. They're like way off. When these get, I live here. When they get good, when they get ripe,
I've
they're good.
I've picked mine a couple times. They're not, and put them in my. Well, I can't tell you.
It's okay.
Cheerios.
It's all right. I'm just saying, these are really, I mean, these are awesome. When they're ripe, they're amazing. But until they're ripe, they're not good.
You can put a net on them, keep the birds out.
There's plenty for all of us.
Okay. See? Say it to them. What? They have nets.
When you have abundance, there's plenty for, this variety, I want you all to get this. This is called, isn't that amazing? Did you hear me what this is?
No, I didn't hear. I'm sorry.
Oh, you missed it. This is huge.
Yeah, sorry.
This is wasabi.
Oh, these are your wasabi.
You know where? Yeah, take a leaf and just see how good it is. How it's not as yeah, eat that.
Yeah, really.
Eat the leaf. It's not as hot as the root, but
no,
it's definitely
I already had it.
Definitely spicy. It's there. But here's what's amazing. Listen to me. Wasabi only grows in nature in standing water, rivers and stream beds in full shade. And people who grow it commercially get anywhere from $90 to $120 a pound for the roots.
I've seen it grow in Japan.
Yeah. In water.
Yeah.
Hydroponically,
that's
under
correct.
Black cover.
That's correct.
If you notice, this is growing in full sun with no irrigation. Mm-hmm. No one's watering.
Wow.
And what's hilarious is that this is white sage that grows in deserts, and they're growing side by side. It is wild, and it's this amazing, and you know, see this plant right here? This came from Israel. This is what they grow in the desert in Israel. Yeah. I don't know its name. My wife got it. It's in Israel. It's,
can you smell it?
Yeah. They grow this in the desert there.
Is it za'atar?
What is it?
Huh?
Za'atar?
It might be.
What is this one?
It comes from Israel, and it grows in the desert there. So I'm growing it next to wasabi that grows in shade, you know, in full.
What, oregano? Is that
no, it's from Israel. I think she got the name, though.
Za'atar.
I think that's it.
This tastes like a sage and oregano and thyme. Mm-hmm. You know, it's got thyme in it, too. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. You know what's crazy? It's your chives.
Aren't they good?
Nuts.
Sweet.
They are so nuts and
Sweet.
So healthy. It's like a
look
it's
at
like
me.
A bush.
Yay, God.
I know.
God does cool stuff, man.
I know. I want to take it home through customs. I want to see if I can get it through customs.
But you just create this in your yard. You're going to have it. You don't have to take anything home. Just do this at home.
Just
put a cover.
I'm just
telling you, man, it works.
Paul, what's this?
Wow. It's my wife is a midwife. She uses all these herbs in her practice, and I don't even know their names. But see this thing here, I got to cut back because you see it's going to seed, and I'm gonna have to cut it back. You see, I have the most amazing fennel plant over there. That's cut down. You see the challenge I have here, that if I don't catch something that goes to seed, I have my whole place covered with it.
Oh, wow.
I'm telling you, stopping growth is my challenge, not getting to the growth, trying to stop it. And so I got to cut this back because it's totally going to be over the top.
Can I ask you a little favor?
Yeah.
I'm making some roasted chicken for my sister-in-law tomorrow when I'm staying out. Can I have a couple pinches of rosemary?
You can have as much as you want.
Just take a couple.
You can take all you want. I just told you. The thing needs pruning. It needs.
Really?
Yeah, it's a help.
I don't want to touch anything until I ask you.
You're welcome. I'm just saying, I'm telling you honestly to take all you want.
Okay.
Just, you know, take more than you need.
Awesome.
So she can have some left over.
Awesome. Thank you so much.
Paul, what did you say about the abundance with the blueberries, for example?
These blueberries, I want you all to hear me. This variety is unique. It's called Liberty. Not Liberty.
Where?
Olympia. I got it from a place that's called Sand Hill No, this is Burnt Creek. Burnt Ridge. Orchard and Nursery. They're in Onalaska, Washington, and this variety is amazing.
Wow.
This thing is starting to produce now, and my family eat this every day. I come out every day to eat it, and in October, when the wind blows, there's blueberries. I've never seen a variety go so long.
Wow.
It's incredible, and it's called Olympia.
They're freakishly big.
Oh, these aren't even ripe. They're not even ripe yet.
Yeah.
They get really big.
How old are these bushes?
7 years.
7 years old.
Seven.
Wow.
So,
and you
track with me.
Yeah.
If you need a hedge in your yard,
they
make a great hedge.
Yeah.
You should plant an edible landscape in your yard.
I wish I could have this in Norway.
I love that idea.
I want this in Norway, but they don't sell this
type. Well, get it there. Get it from
I have to smuggle it in through customs then.
Well, do what you got to do.
I know. That's what I'm thinking. No, I'm not above it. I mean, I didn't say I was above it.
Just
awesome.
So, I'm curious about the stuff in your chicken yard.
Let's go.
Okay.
Everybody come to the chicken pen. And I want you to clear your nostrils so you can pick up the chicken odor.
No odor.
Do you think about herbs? Look at that St. John's wort. Ever see St. John's wort that beautiful?
This is it?
Yeah, look how beautiful that is.
Wow.
Lush, totally amazing.
So do you drink it in a tea?
They harvest this, my wife and my daughter, they're and I'm not sure how they use it, but but it all has medicinal value. And you see these gorgeous, that herb there.
You mean
the mullein, look how beautiful that mullein is.
Is it supposed to be that big?
Oh, that's what I'm saying. You don't see him that big anywhere else. It's awesome.
What is this, Paul?
It's some herb my wife has.
Okay.
Now, come here. I want
to
show you guys.
Talk to you at all?
Talk to me? We live together.
I'm just
42
you.
Years married. You know?
I'm just teasing you.
Now everybody check this out, you women.
Yeah.
You see this herb? You see the size of that?
Oh, wow.
Do you know what that is? That is black cohosh that only grows in full shade.
That's ridiculous.
Isn't that awesome for black cohosh?
I've never seen that many flower heads.
Yeah. And you know what that was last year? Last year, it was a plant this size. I'm serious. I planted this size last year.
They usually only have one flower head.
Isn't, and it's in full sun.
Yeah.
It's supposed to be in shade. I love it. You see how it's so fun doing all the things that say you can't?
Which is the St. John's wort?
Right here, the yellow.
Okay, what is that used for something?
Yeah. It's medicinal. Yeah, because I've heard of that. Now, everybody, are you picking up the chicken odor?
What is this? It
smells so bad.
That is, it's autumn olive is the name of that plant.
It's beautiful.
Now, if you guys have approached a chicken pen, usually when you come to a chicken pen, the chickens are running up trying to get something from you because they're hungry. Yeah. You notice my chickens are not at all impacted by your presence. They're ignoring you. You can see what you can see the food they're eating, all that nice romaine lettuce they're working on, and all this night these beet greens. You know, they have such an incredible amount of food. And if you pick up the odor here, there's none. If you look at my fence over there, you see how short it's getting? You see, I gotta take this stuff out of here to my garden because my garden doesn't need it, but I gotta get this down because the chickens are gonna fly out because I have no more fence.
So if I show up with a trailer, I can just help myself?
No, because I'm gonna move this to my garden. I'm gonna get some people here, and you can see we already started down there. You see how low that is? Yeah. I'm gonna work because I wanna get this in my garden because this is awesome stuff. But, and for you, any of you who want fig starts, you see over there that fig tree where the chickens are? You can go in there, and all those little suckers coming from the bottom, you break off at the bottom, and you go home and you plant the whole thing. The leaves are going to fall off, but from that little start, you see that fig tree there? That was a stick I put in the ground 3 years ago.
Oh, wow. They root that easily?
Good. Easily. They're amazing how well they root. And you'll forget that you put it there, and all of a sudden you go, what happened to me? I found this big old, I said, what's that weed? A big old green leaf. Think, oh, that was a fig I planted. I forgot all about it. But it just totally grows great. So you can go in there and break those off and take it home, and you'll have this variety is the only one that gets ripe here. They sell brown turkey and it never ripens. This is called Desert King, and it gets ripe here, which is amazing because most figs do not get ripe in Washington. This one does.
So how long would that last? We're about 5 days away.
Doesn't matter.
It would stay alive long enough to plant it.
If you can, wrap it in like a paper towel, wet in a plastic container, a plastic bag, you're good.
Okay.
What did you say it was called? How many?
Desert King.
Desert King.
It's the most amazing good fig.
Does it just produce fruit once?
That's twice. The second one doesn't ripen because there's not enough heat here.
Okay,
you'll get it.
Probably it
does. Here it puts on two crops, but the second one doesn't ripen because it's not warm enough. It never developed.
Right. My brother has one, I think he says it gets two or three.
Yeah, in California you get two, but here, one. But I get one, and no one else can have any, so it's awesome.
So, is that the same as
that's all of them. It's the only one that gets ripe here.
Desert King? What are those?
Want to go get one?
That fruit tree you have back? Is that a plum?
That's a plum. Do you see the size of those? And they're not even close to ripe. And I wish you were here because I get women coming here. I says, you're going to get wet. Oh, I know how to handle it. And they bite into it, their whole body's wiped out. The thing is so full of water, it's impossible to eat it without getting drenched.
Do they stay that color or do they?
They get yellow, totally yellow. And they get they're huge.
I know, I saw one in the back. And it's like monster
size. And it's not even close to ripe yet. But when they get ripe, you get wet. You get totally wet eating it.
When I see fruits like this, I'm always suspicious about, in the market, how they get that big in the way that they, grow them. Mm-hmm. But here they just grow so naturally big.
They're eating well.
Yeah. But your tree is so few leaves on them. It just looks so sparse, but they're just riddled with fruit. Mm. It's the way you prune.
Because I'm trying to reduce the amount of fruit I get.
Yeah, I know.
I actually, in the fall when I prune,
and help you.
When I prune in the winter, my trees look naked. Like people say, what did you do? Mm-hmm. I says, come back in September. You can't even walk through here. I'm just telling you, man, it's just, that opens out.
Where'd you get your Japanese saw to prune? I know
there's a place in California called Bishop Supply.
Bishop Supply. Is that where you get your...
All my pruning tools.
Really?
And they're the best. Felco makes the nicest hand pruner. Yeah. It's made in Switzerland.
Yeah.
And then the Japanese handsaw Samurai is awesome.
Where did you get them?
Bishop. Bishop Company in Los Angeles.
Where do you get your seeds?
My seeds?
It sounds like you saved them.
Yeah. Initially, let me give you some good companies. Sand Hill Preservation Center. Sand, like sand on the beach, Hill Preservation Center. Baker Creek Heirloom Seeds. And Fedco, F-E-D-C-O. Now, Fedco will have some hybrid, just ignore those and get the heirloom. But they're all good seeds.
Baker Creek, I'm sorry, what was that?
Baker Creek Heirloom Seeds. I don't know if you're aware of it, but all those big seed companies today, all of them are all controlled by Monsanto. Mm-hmm. Johnny's, Jung's, Burpees, all of them are owned.
Monsanto's getting bought out. They're going to become even bigger.
Yeah.
By Dow. Mm-hmm. It's disgusting.
But what you saw today, if we all did this, Monsanto would go bankrupt. Because we will never need anything they have.
Yep.
Nothing they provide will I ever need.
Yeah, I hear you. Do you ever do any just like a fun gardening projects, like a unique thing every, I mean, you have wasabi, that's pretty unique, but like any other, like this year I was going to grow lupa gourds, and you know, it's kind of a fun experiment. Do you ever?
Well, I'm not so much in experimenting. I mean, I do stuff, but you know, I just enjoy stuff that works.
Yeah.
And I like eating good food. And so I just do, you know, like my wife is an herbalist, and so she wanted this black cohosh, you know, so I planted that for her. You know, so, you know, I'm always doing stuff, but I'm not looking for to do something unusual, you know. Because, you know, I'm 66 and I've been around the block a couple times, so, you know, I'm okay.
It's lost its luster, some of that.
What was your scissors that you used?
Fedco.
The scissors. The pruning shears. I'm sorry.
Felco. Felco number 8. That's important, the number. Felco number 8. It's totally awesome. And if you'll take care of those tools, they will last.
How do you sharpen your saw?
You don't. You can't.
Okay. Do you
if you send it out and get it sharpened, it'll come back and won't cut anything. Because the Japanese, when you look at that, it's got like 3 edges. I don't know how they do it.
Yeah.
So when it gets dull, and it won't happen unless you get in the dirt, buy a new blade.
Okay.
Just replace the blade because no one knows how to sharpen them. No one.
The Felco number 8 pruning shears, is that what you're talking about?
Yeah.
Where do those come from?
They're made in Switzerland.
Oh, okay.
And I wish I had my, because it's so amazing how they're made. God, I wish I had my truck. You know what hand pruners is? You use them?
Yeah.
When you first get them, they roll nice and tight. Yeah, that's it. That so fits your hand. It's amazing. When you put in your hand, whoever made that understood.
Sure.
When you have hand pruners, you're using them. When they first get them, they cut real nice. But over time, that jaw wears out and they get floppy and they hinge. You know how they saw that with this? They have a nut that tightens it, and alongside they have this little piece that locks into it, so you can always adjust it to totally tight, lock it into place. I wish I could pull, because my Felcos are totally shiny aluminum. The rubber handles have worn off, because I have thousands of hours on these pruners. Because I'm an arborist, I prune trees every day, kind of thing. And they're as good as the day I bought them.
But how do you maintain it so clean? Do you oil it?
I use oil if I need to, and I hand sharpen it.
Yeah.
How you sharpen, you have that edge, and you get a file and you maintain that edge, and you flip it over, and you go flat on the back and take that burr off, and you're good.
And you're using a stone, right?
I use a flat file.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Wow. Do you buy the file from them too, from Bishop?
No, I just get a good file.
A regular file from any garden?
Anywhere,
home. A home gardening store?
No, a hardware store.
A hardware store, okay. Oh, a file.
Yeah, a metal file. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Because it's a metal blade.
Okay.
But when you go to sharpen it,
what's
scary is a file to scale, because the seal is so hard. You see, you know where the finest haircutting scissors, the finest surgical things are made? In Europe, Germany, Switzerland, Sweden.
Yeah. Usually German.
Americans are we're young. Our steel is not near the quality that the Europeans are.
I sew, and my scissors are German, and I would use no other
scissors. Yeah, they have much better steel.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and so my sense is go to the masters. People do it a while, get the best stuff, take care of it, and you're good for life.
Mm. But the Japanese know how to do knives, though.
Japanese saws. Yeah. I'm telling you, look in my eyes. When you get that saw, you be very careful how you use it. Because you're gonna come through the cut a lot faster than you think.
Really?
And if you come through and you hit your hand, you're gonna have a hole, a gash.
Yeah.
Like I wear gloves when I do my pruning, not because my hands are cold.
Yeah.
I'm trying to protect myself from serious injury. Because that thing is scary sharp. And you come through the cut so fast, You think you're not there, and you're just, oh, all of a sudden you're through and it nails you. So be careful using it because it's deadly.
I hope to come back and take one of your pruning course.
Cool.
Yeah, that's really tricky.
I wish I had my.
Do you
almost,
want to go get it?
I yeah.
Can I go fetch it?
In my truck over there. I want to show you. I'm gonna do the pruning thing right now for you.
Really?
Go in the my truck. Truck that, right? That's the black truck. The yeah. Green truck.
Okay.
Behind the bed is a wooden lid.
Yeah.
In there, you'll find sitting right here on in the front,
yeah.
A scabbard with a saw and a pruner.
Yeah.
Bring the pruner out. It has just a, you know.
Okay, I'll be right
back. And we'll, I'm going to do a Japanese maple.
Oh.
That's awesome.
Your home is very beautiful. Well, your bathroom is very beautiful, so I'm assuming the inside of your home is really beautiful.
Did you like
too.
That outhouse?
I
yes.
Loved it.
Is that a cool looking outhouse?
Are you kidding? That's
I had my neighbor's an artist, and my wife asked him to make it for us.
Oh, okay.
And those windows, I don't know if you noticed.
Yes.
Yeah.
Those windows are leaded glass windows that are so cool because you have privacy and still have light.
Yeah.
You know
yes.
Where they came from?
Where?
From a church that was built in Italy in the 11th century.
Wow.
They're that old.
Wow. How did you find them?
Someone had this guy's an artist, and someone had given those to him. He didn't know what to do with them, so he gave them to us. It was awesome, man. I mean, it's just incredible. So if you notice it doesn't stink in there,
mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
You notice that all outhouses you go to stink?
Mm-hmm.
Let me tell you, let me tell you why.
There's zero.
I'll tell you why. If you go to county outhouses, they don't stink. The ones the county built don't stink. The reason is they use 6-inch vents. Everyone else uses 4-inch.
That's it.
It's ventilation. Those are 6-inch vents.
Yep.
And because I'm an arborist and I'm out working all day long, and I don't have no bath, but I've had to use outhouses. And so when I've been in them and notice when they don't stink, I pay attention why, because I've been around them. Mm-hmm. And I noticed the one with 6-inch vents don't stink, all the rest do. So when the guy was building this, he says, no, we're doing 6-inch, you know, because I know what I'm talking about. And it's amazing wow. How well it works. So 2 inches makes such a difference in volume of air taken out.
So what was this herb called? Mullein.
Yeah, this is mullein. Look how beautiful. You see those on the highway, and they're tiny.
Yeah.
They're just incredible. Yeah, they're amazing.
Oh, weed. Gotta get rid of
it. Come over here. I'm going to do a really quick pruning demonstration, but you're going to love it because it's going to show you how to prune, and it's going to wake you up to how everybody prunes wrong. What's that? No, a little Japanese maple over here, next to that where that lady's sitting.
This year's new growth?
All those shoots are 1 year's growth. And it's a dwarf tree that isn't supposed to do that.
Yeah.
I'm just telling you, man, these things are racking my brain because I've been around this my whole life. I prune trees for a living. I go to people's orchards, man, it's like 6 to 8 inches of growth a year. That's it. Thank you.
Oh, that's plum.
These are all plums.
Yes.
And they get totally huge and they're amazing.
Well, that's, have you seen the size in the back? There's one that's just monster, like steroid size.
No, I use it to grow basil in the summertime. I just need to get it planted this year.
And I saw you had corn. Is that
grows great here, yeah. I get good corn. Plenty of corn.
Is it sweet corn?
That's sweet corn, yeah. Mm-hmm. So pruning. The only culture in the world who knows how to prune are the Japanese. No culture beside them knows how to prune. And all cultures, European cultures where you live, you've all seen how they prune trees. They start from the outside and start hacking ends off, and they look ugly when they're done. They're gross looking, all these stumps in your face. With the Japanese, they start from the inside and work out. Which when you think about it, that's how the tree grew. And it makes such a difference when you approach it that way. So if you look at trees in nature, you look at those sequoias over there, all the fir trees, the branches at the bottom are the longest. And as they go up, they get shorter. There's a reason for that. It's called lighting. If the branches below like this, don't extend out far enough, they're not going to get light. They're not going to do well. So always the lower branches have to be the longest. And if they're not, you better get rid of them because they're not going to make it.
Now, exactly which samurai saw is that? Is there a number or something?
Yeah, this is, I guess it's getting pretty wore out, but yeah, this is a challenge. GCM-330-MH.
Samurai.
May I? Yes. Check that thing out, man. It's awesome.
And the printers, what's
Felco? Felco number 8.
Number 8.
Swiss made. Okay, so you start at the bottom, inside out. You see these branches here don't come out far enough to get sunlight. So they're history. And you always want to cut close, right to the trunk. Cut the collar flat. And so everything going up and down, I'm taking out because I want to develop this to be a nice flat. Here you'll see how this one's going up. It's crowding.
Blocking the light from the guy below it?
Yeah. And see anything coming underneath?
What about that one right there? I'm just curious.
Where?
Right here, sir.
This is still getting light from the back, but look what I'm going to do here. You see, this has got some dead wood right there.
Right.
You're going to notice when I get done, it's going to look like I didn't do anything. And see, the art of pruning, I'm serious, the art of pruning is hiding your cuts. And when you cut close, you see this is how people prune in my culture. They come like this. Yeah. And you got all the stumps to look at. And that's not right. Now watch what I do here to thin this. You see, I take this center out. You see, I just opened up that space. Okay. You see how this is crossing over into that space? You see how now all of a sudden that's just nicely opened?
Yep.
This little guy in the center here, this is never amount to anything. So I get rid of all this little stuff. You see, this stuff is going up.
Getting so up.
You want to develop flat surfaces, not
sideways.
Yeah.
Yeah, horizontal.
You know, now you see as I'm watching how this is flowing into here, because I'm going to leave that. This is crowding it. It doesn't go with the flow. So this should be flowing, and I want to keep this up here. You see how this is crowding in the center? I'm so glad you said, because the printing principle is the same for everything. Everything. Whether it's a rose, cutting back to the fifth thing is stupid. If something's in the wrong place, take it out. If it's in the right place, leave it. You see now this is crowded, so I'm going to take this thing out of the center. You see how that just like, oh, you can just feel like you can breathe now, you know? That's the beauty of pruning and live things, is that you always get new, every year you get new options.
That one was just crowding.
Yeah, it's crowded.
Okay.
You see what's happening here? You see that's laying on top of that one. And so that, and see this is coming underneath. You know, and so it's going to crowd that space.
Do you ever slide any pieces of wood in here to like space new
growth
out?
No, because that's looks ugly, and it's going to damage the bark, and the thing may break and not last. And I hate crutches.
Does it need to be done every year?
At least, sometimes twice, depending on how fast it grows. And if something's in the wrong place, I'm not going to wait for a year to fix it.
Why did you do that one, Paul?
Because,
that was growing
look, but here, this is my top, and that was, you see, back here, this is my highest point, and that was above it. And I'm going, you know, this is my crown, so everything's coming from here down, and that was higher. This is my top.
Yeah.
This is the highest point of my tree, and this was extending beyond it. And I'm going this direction, so everything should do this flow.
Oh, I see.
My head. looking for a central leader, or are you?
There's no such thing as a central leader in this tree.
Okay, gotcha.
See, all these things you're told in books, when you come out to the real world, they don't exist. So throw the books away and get free and use your eye. And again, see, every plant, you know, see, you see, this is just crowded here. So I'm going to take this center out, open it up. See, again, these uprights, this is going up. So I'm going to take it out. Okay, now you see what we've done here? You see how nicely this is arranged, nothing's touching it, everything's fit, and it doesn't appear to you that it was cut. Mm-hmm. Are you getting it? Mm-hmm. The art of pruning is hiding your cuts. When you're done, it should look like you hadn't been there.
So what do you say about like waiting to prune after the fruit, or like they say don't prune until after?
They say. Huh? You notice when you're in my orchard, the interior parts of my trees had absolutely no sucker growth.
And
everybody's trees that you've been around have tons. You know why? Because I don't tolerate it. And you know how I prune it? With my hand. When the little buds, I rub them off. Because I don't want them there, so why let them get big and cut them when they're big? Remove them up front. And so I prune all summer. I walk out in the summertime, I just walk to my trees, just rub them. And just caress them because they're nice trees. I don't. It's a Japanese maple. Some guy who's a landscaper brings his crew in here every year to have me teach him how to prune, and he gave me this a couple years ago. Now, you see how easy that was and simple?
Yep. Well, and it's, okay, no, you made it simple. Yeah. Really.
But I want you to understand there's principle and reasons for what I'm doing, and you can see how everything just fits in. And what's going to happen now because of the pruning? This wood is just going to start expanding, and this tree is going to start growing at levels it's never grown before.
Yeah.
Because nothing makes things grow like pruning. Nothing.
So you wouldn't leave the pruning material down to make
No, because it's offensive to me. It doesn't fit in this Swiss German culture. Everything has a place. It should be in place. I like this, and all that stuff on top of it was cumbersome.
But other than the looks, that could it'd be
fine.
Be beneficial.
Beneficial, yeah. Okay.
If you wanted to, it
works fine because everything. Here's the reality: everything turns back to dirt.
Right.
Everything left to itself turns back to dirt.
Why is this here?
Good eye.
Ah.
Awesome.
Boy, we got another perfectionist.
It's awesome. I'm,
no,
yeah.
I'm just
it was a poor cut. Didn't get it all off.
Yeah.
Oh, I see.
And I'm blessed by you seeing it. Awesome.
I'm just OCD.
That's awesome.
Don't tell that to my husband.
Thank you.
Yes, of course.
You see, OCD has a tremendous ability to pay attention to detail. Detail is really important. It
yes.
is. It's significantly important.
Well,
detail. Seeing detail.
I didn't believe it.
A lot of people see that they don't see, and that's awesome. You have an eye, and see, it's been trained.
Not everybody agrees with that, though.
It doesn't matter. I'm being real. I'm just telling you.
Yeah.
You want to do things really well.
I know a couple people. That
and you care about detail.
Yeah, very detail oriented.
It's miserable to try to find some. My kids used to do my orchard. This is hilarious. The rule of thumb was if I can find three weeds in a minute, you're not done. Okay, Dad, we're done. I walk out there, and they couldn't believe it, man. Instantly, I got three weeds. Says, how did you see that?
Because it sticks out like a sore thumb.
My eye's been trained to notice detail.
Mine too.
And see, a lot of people aren't. And when you're doing any kind of work, it matters. Detail is important if you're doing work.
I was just sharing with one of the other gentlemen, we were standing by ourselves over there, and I said, visually, I would probably get really frustrated looking at your garden when I see a squash coming out of the ground, but because you have wood chips and the area around it is so clean that it looks sort of strategic that it's supposed to be there, you know? So visually, when I've seen your videos and all these years I've been watching in Norway, I'm like, how does he get it so that it's so perfectly lined up, the grass and the and you know, the gardening area, it is so straight. I mean, I know you're an arborist.
I use a line trimmer on my grass.
Yeah.
And I use strings in my garden to run straight rows, I just told you.
Yeah.
And again, it's this whole thing of like OCD demanding excellence.
Excellence. It really speaks to me though.
OCD really is excellence.
No, it's not. It's not when you are, when you're the one that has to.
I'm not going to change.
Everybody else around.
I'm not going to change.
Yeah.
I demand excellence.
Yeah.
And I don't care what they call it.
Yeah.
I just think excellence is awesome. And I just will not change.
I know, but you know, when you pursue your life that like that, it does get exhausting for the people around you sometimes because they're forced to rise, you know, to that occasion. And that's why
I'm a recluse, why go nowhere, and why I've always worked for myself. Are you hearing me? I've worked for myself my whole life because I demand excellence.
Yeah.
And it just doesn't work in the marketplace, you know?
Somebody found them.
But you made a really wonderful choice to live like this with for your family and for yourself. You know,
I'm thankful.
Yeah.
I got a good father.
You took a big.
But I have a good father who really helps me.
People want to see what your eggs look like because you always talk about
them. Well, crack it open and show them.
I always hear your voice.
There just happens to
be. And then when you're done, my dog will take care of it for you.
Really?
Yeah.
So your chickens even lay eggs and plates?
You demanded excellence from your chickens. They laid it right in the plate.
No, that someone put it in that plate. I know where they laid it. But you see my dog? You see that dog's hair over there? You see how it shines? Well, you're going to see in a minute why. Because when they finish cracking this egg, she's going to eat it. And she eats a raw egg every day.
Who knows how to crack an egg, Wolf? Because that's not me.
Okay, you.
No.
I know how to crack an egg.
No,
I don't know.
I've had enough.
Well, let's do that.
No.
Whoever can do it, please.
It's not that
egg. Okay.
That big
egg.
Just stay on the plate there for us.
Okay. What? I did it extra hard because I heard that they were tough.
Was it tough?
It was tough.
Oh, look at that. Stand up.
See how orange that yolk is?
Yeah.
You know what that's called? That's from? Greens.
Mm-hmm.
My
and
chickens
bugs?
Greens. Chlorophyll. Green. They eat a lot of greens.
Anyone want to play with the shell?
My dog with the shell too.
Hard.
The shell too?
Yep.
Oh. Really?
Put all the dish.
Tova!
Wow.
Tova! Tova! Come, girl! Tova! Tova!
Tova,
she's eating. Come, Tova! Come! Come, girl! Got an egg for you!
Like,
no.
Come on, Tova! Tova!
My son loves you.
Just bring it to me!
Tova! Hey! Tova!
Oh, wow.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. That's resistant to you.
What? Cool!
Is it breaking even?
It didn't even break.
It's potent, man.
Mommy!
This is the kind of eggs you need in an egg egg throwing contest. You'd win hands down.
Look at that. You really pushed your finger into it, didn't you?
Isn't it awesome?
Yeah.
My wife never break an egg again.
A fingernail.
Anybody got a fork?
Well, you got it now.
You got a good fingernail.
You just touch one in the store and it goes through.
Wow.
Tova. Come on, girl.
Oh, I see that.
Where's the shell?
Where's the shell?
Okay.
The shell?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, really?
What?
Well, just watch it.
It's like dessert.
Yeah, video.
What the dunk? What are you thinking?
Is it a boy or a girl?
Girl.
Yeah. The lab. Yeah, you're that. Right. You're right. Oh, my goodness.
Best part for last.
I'm telling you, man. This is normal. This is normal. They know what good food is.
Now, Paul, do you eat the eggs?
I love eggs. Yeah. Tova. Tova.
Eat them raw or cook them?
Both. Both.
How old is your dog?
16.
How many eggs?
And look at, there's not one gray hair.
Her muzzle's not.
On average, how many eggs do you eat a week?
Mommy.
Well, it depends on the season. When there's when I have abundance, I eat a lot. When there's not, I don't eat any. So I can eat six at a time because they don't have cholesterol. My eggs have no cholesterol. I'm just but mine don't because all the stuff in the store does.
Yeah.
Listen, they did a test at Sunny Farms. This guy used to raise his chickens outside in open fields, and they're selling his eggs. So the state came in and they did a test because they wanted to see the cholesterol content. They did the test 3 times. Something's wrong with the machine because no cholesterol was there. Chickens free range, eating live food, don't have cholesterol in their eggs. The creator didn't create cholesterol in eggs. It's all done by corrupted, genetically modified, dead food.
Oh, so you don't have to supplement their feed at all?
Look at me. All of you. If you look at nature, you ever see a pheasant in nature, how beautiful the feathers are?
Yeah.
No chicken in any pen looks that good. Who's feeding the pheasant grain? Excuse me. Who's feeding it grain? It gets some grain in the summer when the grass goes to seed, but all winter long it has no grain. And it looks way better than those chickens getting grain. My chickens get no grain, ever. Ever. They eat kale all winter. I don't buy them any food. I raise all their food. I don't buy myself food. Why would I buy it for my chickens? The stuff in the store isn't any good. Why would I do it to my chickens? I like my chickens. Why would I give them corrupted food?
I just love your message. It's so simple.
It's
awesome.
It's the truth.
It just makes me feel stupid.
It's the truth. But you got lied to in school.
I've been told a lie, yeah.
You got lied to. And you came today to get the lie erased and realize that I have a good brain. I know how to think. My eyes work quite well. And I get it.
So for you, the fruits and the vegetables are enough, and the eggs?
Are enough.
What about nuts or
all those things, if you read Genesis, vegetables, fruits, and their seeds, nuts or seeds, is what I've given to you for food. Mm-hmm. It's all there.
And do you grow nuts?
I have, I'm not here, but I could grow walnuts, but I don't grow any here, but I buy almonds and good walnuts because nuts are really good. See, when you think about seeds, everybody hear me. This is huge. You ever look at a seed? How tiny they are? Mm-hmm. Celery seed is almost like dust. You track with me. In that tiny seed is enough life force to create a stem and 2 leaves before there's any root. Mm-hmm. That's all in the seed. Seeds are the most compacted food of anything on the planet. It's the most compacted food. Seeds are amazing food. You know, incredible. And see, all your grains, those are seeds. You know, seeds are awesome. Nuts are all seeds. You know, so seeds are really, really beneficial food.
Just a quick reminder, Burnt Ridge Nursery.
Burnt Ridge Nursery and Orchard is in Onalaska, Washington.
Onalaska
is the city it's in, and they have that Olympia blueberry.
A question for you. Back in Genesis, what made them think it was a good idea to start killing?
Oh, I'm so glad you asked. Everybody want to hear something amazing? You will never get this in church. I don't care where you've been, no one in church will ever tell you this. But when I tell you, you're going to blow your mind and how it's going to resonate with your spirit. Because I asked God, when I saw how simple this was, I couldn't figure out why Adam, an intelligent being who knew how to do it right, would create all this work for himself and us. It makes no sense. He knew better. He knew better. Why would he start tilling when he knew better? So God walked me through how he got there. It was huge. When Adam sinned, God came down for his normal walk. You following me? Adam, where are you? Let's go for a walk. I'm over here hiding. Why are you hiding? At that tree I shouldn't have. I'm naked. What did God do? In his kindness, redemptive nature, he killed an innocent animal because of the shedding of blood, there's no remission of sin, and he made clothes to cover them. So he demonstrated his forgiveness and his redemptive nature. Demonstration. The devil came behind and said, Adam, you're an orphan. You don't have a father anymore. You blew it. And Adam took on an orphan spirit. The Bible says, as a man or woman thinks in their heart, so are they. He believed he was an orphan. The orphan spirit is, I'm on my own, I have no support, it's all about me. So God walked me through the process. When he went outside the garden, it took him quite some time to clear the cover off the earth to expose dirt, because it was well covered. That took him time. He wasn't fasting, he's eating while he's doing this. Then he had to design in his mind a tilling device and make it. No box doors. He had to design and make the tilling device. Then God really got my attention. Where do you think he got the seeds to plant his garden after he tilled it? Where did he get the seeds to plant his garden after he tilled it?
They were already in the soil.
In the soil?
Mm-hmm.
It couldn't have been because he took the cover off to expose the soil.
Oh. Did he bring it with him from the garden?
No.
From the fruit that he was eating.
There it is.
Nice.
There it is. He's eating every day this amazing food, and the food that he's eating has seed in it. And he knew that from his garden experience. And so I'm blown away. So here, the reality is he's being well taken care of. He's being well provided for. And then the Holy Spirit connected the dots, because the word says, the mouth of truth he witnesses, truth is confirmed. And the Holy Spirit took me to the Sermon on the Mount. Jesus says this in the Sermon on the Mount. Consider the birds of the air and all the animals. They don't sow, they don't reap, and they don't store food in barns. But your Heavenly Father takes care of them. Then he poses a question to get our attention. He says, aren't you of more value than them? And what Jesus is saying is, the Father planned on taking care of you all the same way. You believed a lie, took on an orphan spirit, and you've been living in that state of depravity ever since because you believed a lie. I'm just telling you, man, as I watch what's happening here, as I'm experiencing my lifestyle, I have no shortage. I have nothing but abundance. It's provided for me every day. And I go to no stores. I buy nothing. And I'm getting it. This is the nature of my Father. This is who He is. And I'm connecting. I'm getting it. I'm going to Him. Believe in Him. And He just, can I give you more?
Mommy?
Ah, He just is generous. And I'm getting, we believed a lie. And that's how we got here. It's huge. Influence is huge. He got under the influence of the devil and believed the lie, I'm an orphan, and lived in that reality because you are what you believe. It's powerful. It's powerful.
Can I put this back for you?
Thank you so much. You're so sweet. Appreciate you. See, you'll never get that in church. But you know when I'm saying it, it's what happened. That's really what happened. Yeah.